He certainly looks the part, doesn't he? But is this type of circuit going to suit his style, do you think?
Well, so far this season, you know, he really has been the class of the field. He's dominated the championship. He's won twice. He's the only driver to do that. But he's led so many more laps than anybody else. So he's head and shoulders above the others. But here in particular, in qualifying, he's way, way ahead of the other guys. He's on pole by 0.3 seconds, which on a circuit of this length is a huge, huge margin. And if you consider that second to third place are split by 0.02 seconds,
yeah,
it's like that all the way down the grid.
But Chris, it is a track with a reputation, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's absolutely beyond question that we're going to see a very incident-packed race. And he's starting in the right place. The idea of driving on a circuit like this is to get out in front of the
trouble. Absolutely, if you can get there, stay there. Right, well, we've heard a lot about the circuit. Let's take a look then at the track facts, and here they are. As we said earlier, Dover Downs, it's called the Monster Mile. It is 1 mile round with very high-banked, paved oval circuit. Unusual surface too, as Christopher said earlier. The straight's very short, just over 330 yards, that is, isn't it? Just over 1,000 feet. And the turns too, pretty tight, just over 1,500 feet. It really is a very fast, very exciting, potentially very dangerous circuit. Capacity enormous, more than 100,000 people, permanent seating potential, 107,000 actual permanent seats, and 40 sky boxes. Those are the luxury VIP penthouses for the lucky ones. And it's the only track, as we said earlier, to have on-site gambling at the Monster Mile. And finally, well, we can tell you that it's the leader in harness horse racing. That's something which we didn't touch on, but you can. Apparently, when they're not motor racing, they're racing or trotting horses. And the weather, thankfully, it's looking good. 80 degrees, and it's no chance of rain, so we understand. So there we are, that's the situation as far as the circuit is concerned. We understand the cars are pretty well ready out there on the track. We can now join our colleagues at CBS Television, Mike Joy, former Indy 500 winner, Tom Sneaver, and Ken Squire.
Buddy Lazier with two IRL victories. Sophomore driver Dr. Jack Miller and Robbie Unser, fifth at Indy as a rookie. Eddie Cheever, the Indy winner, and Sam Schmidt. Row 10, USAC Sprint Car star Brian Tyler, and Jim Guthrie's back after that bad crash at Indy. Engine trouble in qualifying for Marco Greco and Scott Harrington in relief of Eliseo Salazar. Field forming up behind the safety car.
And chassis in the race today, really the first track that the G-Force is actually maybe being the dominant car in qualifying. Tony Stewart has both the Dallara and the G-Force, elected the G-Force through testing and then put it on the pole. Oldsmobile, again, the dominant motor, Infiniti working real hard to try to close that gap. The tire situation doesn't seem to be a big concern. There's a lot of grip and they're all doing well.
Getting set for a start at Dover Downs. 248 miles. Green flag.
Davey Hamilton jumped out in front of Tony Stewart early.
A good safe start. Turn three, here comes Stewart on the bottom. No.
Davey Hamilton, Reebok car, had an excellent start.
A good start here for the Pep Boys Indy Racing League at Dover. Five cars have broken away from the field.
Again, coming off of turn two, a good shot down that back straightaway. You just see Greg Ray, the green car, the dark green car, made a nice pass on the outside right there.
Moves up to sixth, leading the second pack. A tight five-car draft, Tom. We didn't see much drafting in practice.
Well, they were a little concerned about this racetrack. They weren't sure what they could get away with, so a lot of guys didn't run real close in the practice sessions.
On board with Scott Sharp.
Again, you can see the steering wheel shaking around. We'll go by some lighter spots on the racetrack, and those are the areas where they actually ground down the racetrack to try to reduce the roughness of the surface.
Turn two, back straightaway. Tony Stewart out in front now. Davey Hamilton, that's Mark Dismore, the red, white, and black car in third. Scott Sharp in fourth, and Jeff Ward, the former motocrosser, they have broken away from the pack.
Well, Ward, he had a little bit of a problem qualifying. He was one of the quickest cars in each practice session. We got somebody slowing down on the inside. But Ward was one of the quickest guys in practice and had a battery or electrical problem qualifying, and it hurt his qualifying time.
Division Air car, John Paul Jr., had a strong start, and he's on board as he rolls to pit lane.
You can see him reach with the left hand. That's really an area where they adjust the fuel mixture. Pretty unfortunate for this team. This team is real happy with this driver change with John Paul and the effort he's given.
Second place as they lap underneath Jim Guthrie, making his IRL return. Mark Dismore has closed right up on Davey Hamilton. Let's go to pit road and Dick Bergeron.
We're off to a good, safe start, and that's a relief for everybody. If you were to talk to the stock car guys who race here regularly, they would tell you that they were fearful for the IndyCar drivers here. When told that these guys are running 30 miles an hour faster than the stock car track record, they're running wide open all the way around, and peak speed only differs by some 4 miles an hour from the slowest speed, the stock car guys just shook their heads and said, we can't imagine how they can do it. So far, they're doing it very well.
One of those guys was Winston Cupper Jimmy Spencer, who was here and won the Busch Grand National North race yesterday. He just watched the Indy cars and just kind of shook his head. Loved it. Loved to see him on this racetrack.
Well, they actually tried to talk him into the car, but he felt maybe too many hamburgers would keep him out of that car.
Now, Stewart is working the high side of race traffic.
Going by Kenny Breck, the white and orange car.
Second place battle underneath Jack Miller, and that'll cost Mark Dismore some distance on the car at the bottom of the screen. Davey Hamilton in second.
Well, you can see Ward on the outside. They got slowed up just a little bit and gave Ward a chance to try the outside for a position pass.
He's working on Scott Sharp right now. There they are. Ward to the outside. John Paul Jr. has climbed from his car, number 10. And it'll roll back to the garage. Short day. Ralph Shaheen.
Now, Mike, it looks like an engine problem for John Paul Jr., who's crawled out of the car. As you said, there is nothing in the engine. They are done for the day.
God, we're missing some great racing right there, passing on both sides, getting into the corners. Some great stuff out there.
Quite a disparity in speeds between the lead lap cars and some of the other cars on the racetrack here. Kenny Breck's car slow down the front straightaway, off the pace.
And some of these speeds we're seeing here on the graphics are traffic related. If they were by themselves in clean air, it would be one thing, but traffic here can be really a hindrance for these guys.
Tom, it doesn't look like there's anywhere on this track you can escape traffic, even with just 22 cars.
No, and it doesn't look like Stewart's having much trouble with the traffic right now. I mean, he might not be in a class of it by himself, but it doesn't take long to take roll right now for that class.
He just went past Ryan Tyler. Put Tyler one lap down. Stewart's last lap, 178.7 miles an hour in traffic. Mark Dismore, who is not in traffic, last lap, 182.3. Kenny Breck has come to pit road.
Yeah, there's something wrong with that car. The leader was lapping him after just 7 or 8 laps into the race, so they've got some kind of problem.
And Scott Harrington's car, the backup car for Salazar, is also in the pits. There's Breck. Dick Bergeron.
Breck is in here right now. He has slowed right from the very beginning of the race. Crew chief John King went out with a fistful of tools, but all they're doing so far is just changing the tires on this race car. They've got all four changed.
I'm not sure they were holding him, or Breck wasn't sure he wanted to go back out there with just a change of tires.
This battle for second, third, fourth.
Scott Sharp right here slid underneath. It looked like it was probably Greco, and definitely got his attention. I think he surprised him quite a bit right then.
They were also lapping Jim Guthrie at the time, and that has spread apart some of the leaders, as right now Jeff Ward has lost touch with Scott Sharp. Tony Stewart, your leader. There's Stewart. Here's Ralph Sheheen.
Mike, the bumps on this racetrack as they cross over the sections of concrete are so bad for the drivers that their eyes are just vibrating furiously to the point that most of the drivers cannot see their gauges.
Hard in the wall, Ralph, and that is the 35. It is Jeff Ward spinning as Jack Miller, spinning as Scott Goodyear. Miller plows into the back of Ward, but Jeff Ward hit the wall in turn four a ton. The right side wheels and suspension have been stripped from the car. Ward, of all the drivers here, perhaps in the best of physical condition, and he is going to climb out under his own power.
Yeah, it looks like Jack Miller is moving around in there too, and there's Goodyear, so it looks like all the drivers are okay. The last two guys, Goodyear and Miller, were really, you know, they were a half a lap back, but things happen so fast on this racetrack that you can get involved real easily.
And the exit from turn four to the front straightaway, because there's also an inside wall, is somewhat blind. So chances are the drivers, even though they have radio control with their spotters, they don't see the incident until they come onto the straightaway.
Well, that's one of the tough things about these mile tracks. It's hard to look across the corner to see what's happening on the exit as you're entering, because you get your hands full.
An incredibly hard hit. Something had to break on Ward's car because he was in the low groove, right down against the track apron, and the car just rocketed up to the wall and impacted it.
Well, that's one of the tough things about running here in the IndyCars. They like the low groove. It's faster. They can run flat out up higher, but it takes another two tenths to get around.
Ralph Sheheen.
Well, we've caught up with Jeff Wardy standing by with his wife. Wardy, what happened? You all right?
Yeah, I'm fine. Just going through the middle of three and four, the front right A-arms or something snapped, and it just went straight up in the wall. Kind of the same thing Salazar did yesterday in practice, and I'm afraid it's probably not going to be the last one today. The track's real rough, and it's just unfortunate because we had a good car and moved up real well, but you know, I'm just glad I'm okay. It was a pretty hard hit, and hopefully everybody else is all right as well.
Can you explain what it's like inside the cockpit, how violent the ride is?
Well, it's just, you know, it's just a vibration, like maybe, you know, compared to learning on the smooth tracks, it's like having all four tires out of balance, you know, the whole time, and it's just something you got to get used to. But I like to thank, you know, the ISM crew for a great job, and Tabasco, Superflow, Prima Donna Resorts, Prolong, everybody. It's three races in a row. It just makes it real tough to the championship, and but we'll be back.
All right, Wardy, glad to see you're okay. Mike, this is one of the best conditioned athletes you'll find anywhere, Jeff Ward. This is a gentleman who runs triathlons for a hobby.
Well, that car is not going to run anywhere. The right side is completely stripped from Jeff Ward's car. There is a look behind the driver compartment, and you see where the right rear suspension was. And look at the right front. Tom, there's nothing left.
There's supposed to be all the suspension pieces, the upright, and a tire and wheel assembly there, and it's all gone.
But all of that material helped to absorb the impact. Jeff Ward just took a tremendous hit into the wall.
Well, you can see the impact here, all the marks along the concrete wall. But, again, a testimony to how strong these cars are, because the driver jumps out and uninjured.
Now, Jack Miller is okay. He has climbed out of his car and is talking to one of the rescue workers at start-finish next to the inside pit wall. Scott Goodyear also climbed out of his car okay. Both of them had to spin to try to miss the Ward car. Now, there's Jack Miller. Goodyear spun down to the inside wall. Miller spun his car, and it ended up sliding into Jeff Ward's machine and then to the inside wall.
When they've pushed Goodyear's car back into the pit area, and they're actually trying to get it back to their pit stall to see if they can't maybe make some kind of changes or adjustments to keep that car in the race.
It didn't look too bad, Tom. He just took a light hit into the inside wall. So they're pushing that car back.
And again, they're going so fast. They come upon the accident so quick. And here we've got a shot of it. Ward, that's the tail end. Ward's up against the wall, so we don't see him get in it. But you see him sliding down the racetrack. Now, this is the front straightaway. He got in trouble in the middle corner. Leyendyke on the inside. He gets by without a problem. What we don't see from this angle is how these guys are getting out of the throttle. There comes Jack. He spun 360 and clips what's left of the back of the car.
Boy, Sam Schmidt just snuck through there on the inside. Steve Knapp that has just got past.
Here we are. There's Wardy up against the wall. You can see the tires coming down the racetrack. Goodyear's back there. Now, here comes Jack Miller on the outside. Goodyear sort of moved up into Jack, and they made contact, and both got involved.
I think the reason Goodyear ended up into Miller is he ran over the wing from Ward's car. That had to do damage.
Well, this is inside Goodyear. Now, this is inside Goodyear. Well, you could see Jack came, he was going quite a bit faster than Goodyear. Goodyear slowed down quite a bit, and Jack Miller was running quite a bit quicker. But again, Goodyear's just trying to miss pieces. This is inside Leyendyke now. Look at, he's just down low, trying to miss all the debris. He gets through, no problem.
These bank tracks are self-cleaning. Eventually, what goes up top is going to slide down to the bottom.
Again, you see Ward up against the outside wall. Parts are coming down the racetrack. Everything slides to the bottom. These guys are just dodging pieces. And, you know, Goodyear sort of came up. Jack was going quite a bit faster than Goodyear, and those two got together, and they both spun.
Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Well, Scott Goodyear had climbed out of his race car on the speedway. They hooked it up with a tow truck, brought him back to the garage area. Chief mechanic Kevin Blanchett, no, 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 and they frantically pushed this thing down to his pit stall. Goodyear climbed back in again. The mechanics went to work on the nose, which was blunted. They replaced it, refired the engine, and Goodyear's going to rejoin the race.
So we're under caution here at Dover Downs, 27 laps complete, and we'll be right back.
Well, they call it the Monster Mile. It's starting to live up to its reputation. Jeff Ward, we were hearing from there, Christopher. He seemed to be saying his car actually broke. Something went at the back. That accounted for him hitting the wall so hard.
Yeah, no, he didn't like the sound of that, saying the car's suspension was breaking and making reference to Eliseo Salazar's accident yesterday. His is a G-Force. Ward's is a G-Force.
Right.
Salazar's is a Riley and Scott chassis. But both A-arms breaking on the suspension sounds very unpleasant. We were talking earlier about the concrete surface and that sort of thumping they're getting.
Yeah.
I wonder if the cars are strong enough, obviously, to survive an accident, and it's great to see them getting out of the cars without any damage to themselves, but are the car's suspensions strong enough to actually race on this sort of surface? Tell you what, I don't fancy being Scott Goodyear. Having been in an accident like that, seen other people talking about suspension breakages, and being told by the team, back you get in, son, and off you go again. I mean,
Chris, we've heard from several sources there about how rough this track is. We're saying that the drivers actually can't even read the gauges. There's such incredible vibration. Is that going to be an additional problem, and could it have contributed to this accident?
Well, it's a problem for two reasons. First of all, it's taking its toll on the cars, as we've already seen.
Yeah.
But certainly it's a tough enough circuit as it is, with the degree of banking and the short nature of the track not giving the drivers much of a breather. But a constant vibration is really going to tire the drivers out, so I wouldn't be surprised to see one or two unforced errors later in the race, just because some of these guys are just getting knackered, basically.
The strange thing was, just before that incident, we were saying, well, we've got off to a pretty good start here. We've done more than 20 laps, no yellows. It's looking good. And in fact, Stewart was looking very impressive, wasn't he?
Yeah, we spoke too soon, definitely. And I would certainly expect, and I'm sure he's expecting to see plenty more trouble throughout the rest of the race.
Well, I think we got a chance to see the incident once again. Christopher, this is as it happened, and it's impressive, slightly worrying shots, these, aren't they?
Yeah, Goodyear's a very experienced guy and has been racing on ovals for a long time. And you can see he's very sensibly backed off. He's minding his own business, looking to see which way the wreckage is going, dodging left and right. And our good friend, the dentist, Jack Miller, appears. And I'm not sure he should really have clipped Scott like that. I think it's up to everybody to back off and take care. But maybe he'd been damaged already, because he was flying when he hit him.
He sure was. Right, obviously a lot more still to come in this race. I think we can now cross back to the circuit and rejoin coverage from our colleagues in America.
Tony Stewart is our race leader. He's now led 16 of the 19 Pep Boys Indy Racing League events. He's led 10 of the 11 races on mile tracks so far. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Well, Scott Goodyear had come into the pit area here, and they did some more work on the car in the back end. This is the nose. This is what they took off his race car. You can see how it's all pushed in. This is a carbon fiber nose, broken a little bit further up as well. He just came back in. I think they've got some suspension component problems as well. They had hoped this was their only problem. It was a quick change, though. I'll tell you what, Tom Steven, they got this thing off and on fast.
Well, and they do a good job. They only changed that one element to get him back there so they wouldn't lose any more laps than they had to, and now they're coming back in to make more evaluations.
There's the new nose on Scott Goodyear's car. He is five laps down.
If there's any question, put that seven on there, the lowest
You heard that comment, put 10-7, put the lowest stagger. That indicates the chassis is probably, the driver feels the car is loose. The back end of the car is loose. They're trying to decrease the stagger to try to put some understeer, some push in this car to make it a little easier for the driver to drive.
And you notice they're entering the pits at turn three at the end of the back straightaway. The stock cars pit off turn four, but that's a very difficult transition. So they come into the pits at turn three and go and transition back up onto the racetrack at turn two. This is one of four cars that have made pit stops under the caution here at Dover Downs. We'll be right back.
A land of sea, sun and sand for 4 days plays host to some football greats both past and present who lace up their boots to challenge for the title of Seven-a-Side Kings. The Trinidad and Tobago Soccer Sevens starts Monday at 7, Sky Sports 3.
What is it with you old marrieds? You've been at the Oysters.
Funny you should say that. We did go for Oysters the other day. This little place down by the sea.
I want to leave.
Never got round to that. Must have been the sea air.
Peugeot 306. The drive of your life.
Dore chocolate ice cream. Real chocolate pieces in real chocolate ice cream. Leaves only one thing on your mind. Think I'll skip straight to dessert.
From £11,995, you can buy a Peugeot 306 Meridian with air conditioning. Perfect for when things get a little hot.
Well, we're underway with the Pep Boys 400 from Dover Downs. Chris Goodwin, we saw Scott Goodyear, and we heard indeed, changes being suggested to the setup of the car. Explain to me, if you will, what that was about and why.
Well, they've hurriedly repaired his car to get him back on the circuit, and he's gone out behind the pace car at a slow speed and checked the car out, and obviously there's something not to his liking, so they're actually changing the tyres to try and affect the handling of the car. But what it shows you is that in the impact that he was in with Jack Miller, something bent in the impact in the suspension, so something's not quite right with the car. So I should think he's fairly worried at the moment.
I should think he is. And of course, you haven't really got much time to sort these things out. You've got to get it right straight away and you're back in there.
No, well, such a short lap, they've only got a very few seconds before they get put another lap down, so they've got to do a very quick change, get him back out there, and he could make two or three stops under the yellow flag.
Just we shall see. Chris, thank you very much indeed for that. Let's see if we can now cross back to the circuit, and away we go once again.
248 laps. Tony Stewart has led most of them. Let's have another look at Jeff Ward's crash up between turns three and four.
You'll see him right there, way back in the corner. That car had to brake early in the corner, and he got up there all the way around, down the front straightaway, and now there's... You can see Jack Miller and Scott Goodyear get together.
The tough thing, Tom, is he was right at the bottom of the racetrack when things let go, and it was a long ride from there to the top and the wall.
Again, this is Goodyear. You see he gets debris on the right front. That's where he gets some damage, and then Jack Miller and him get together.
The leaders will pit under this caution. Here's Dick Berggren.
Well, this is exactly what Larry Curry promised us this morning he was going to do, Mike. He said he is going to play the pit stops at this race based on cautions and nothing else. I haven't been watching the stock car races, I guess. Tony Stewart now in his pit area. They're going to do four tires and fuel on this thing. About half this crew, you'll notice, is in blue uniforms. They're from the team car of Robbie Buell, which isn't here today. There he goes. Stewart is gone. 10.9 seconds. A great stop for Tony Stewart.
When he was the first out, you saw Davey Hamilton exit the pits right after him, so not much change in the order in the first couple cars.
Most of the field has pitted under this caution. Thomas Sieving at work with Scott Goodyear, who was involved in that incident, but is now back on the track.
Yeah, Scott, this is Tom Sneva up in the booth. Scott, you can hear him talk to his other guy. Scott, can you hear us up in the booth? He was just talking with his crew a little bit, so he's got his hands full trying to get this car sorted out.
One car. Starter has green flag in hand, so looks like we'll get a restart this time by.
Drop on a pace car. It's halfway down a backstretch.
John Paul Jr. is in the garage. Kenny Breck has electronics problems. They thought spark plug wires. It may go deeper than that. Jack Miller was involved in the incident. So was Jeff Ward. Dick Berggren.
Well, Breck's car, Mike, you're right. It may well go deeper than that. They have changed just about everything electronic on that car. John King, the crew chief, however, says they do not yet have the problem. He has gone into the garage area for more significant repairs.
Raul Boisel is the race's third leader. As we go back to green, it is the first time he has led an IRL race. Jim Guthrie having trouble getting up to speed. Back under green.
Well, again, Mike, you can see that some of the guys did not take advantage of that pit stop, and they remained out. Schmidt's out there. Both the Cheever cars stayed out. Robbie Unser.
And Cheever drops to the inside, makes a pass, moves up to fourth. Good racing mid-pack. That in the middle of your picture is Stewart. Oh. Way down to the apron, Scott Sharp. He saved it. Oh, my gosh.
You don't get away with that one very often. When you run her down on the transition, the car's got to get unstabilized tremendously, but they got away with it. No crash. Marco Greco on the outside. Goodyear, Sharp, both. And Greg Ray in the Conseco car both get by.
Marco Greco in the red car was up where he was supposed to be. They told the cars being lapped to stay high on the racetrack.
Right. They thought that'd be a little safer situation. If you're off speed a little bit, leave room underneath. There's Lion Dyke in the black and white car right there, followed by Dismore. Dismore's been very quick. This is inside Lion Dyke. Right behind Lion Dyke is Dismore, who's had a good weekend.
Cheever. Running down, leader Raul Boisel. Eddie Cheever in that teal-colored car looking for the lead. Jim Guthrie's been black flagged, slow on the racetrack.
Well, Cheever didn't qualify that well, and he was real concerned. He knew he was running a lot of throttle. He's been running wide open since he got here, he told us, but he'd been 2 or 3 miles an hour off for the qualifying situation.
Here comes Stewart underneath Cheever and steals second spot away.
Well, and I'm not sure Cheever wanted to leave that inside groove open, but...
he blocks. Well, I don't say blocks, but he protects the track against Scott Sharp.
He decided to maybe not make that quite so easy on the bottom side, but you can see Stewart just go right through the traffic.
He's right back to the lead. Tony Stewart in yellow and red over Raul Boisel, Eddie Cheever, and Scott Sharp. Greg Ray has moved up to fifth, Unser to sixth, Davey Hamilton seventh, Ari Lyandike, Mark Dismore, and Lazier.
You see how quick they come off the corner there. I mean, they get up the hill in a hurry.
Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Dr. Jack Miller's just come out of the Infield Care Center. How are you and what happened to you out there?
Oh, I'm fine, thank you. Jeff Ward obviously hit the wall and some debris came off. I went high to miss him. I hit some of his debris and thought I had got by, and I know Scott Goodyear didn't see me and turned up and caught me, and it spun me out, and then I ran in the back of Jeff, and I'm sure he didn't mean to do that, because during a wreck it's survival of the fittest. Everybody's just trying to get through, so it's kind of a shame. We went through some adversities this weekend, but we had a good race car.
Mike, they'll load up and head to Charlotte. Practice starts there in 4 days.
And caution is out as Mark Dismore comes to pit road. This was the fastest car in practice, and it has lost an engine. Oh, Dismore, popular pick among the Railbirds for a top three finish today. Hoping for his first IRL win, he came close at Orlando. Five laps from the checker, needed to pit for fuel, and they have lost the engine.
And again, no accident for this yellow. I think it's just for debris or something, parts of this motor that were left on the racetrack, possibly.
Let's see what happened to Mark Dismore.
Right there, there's Mark. The middle car there, you can see the smoke come out of the back of it. Usually that means they've burned a piston or knocked a hole in the piston.
Everybody gets by without incident. And he's out of the car and out of the race. High attrition in the opening laps here at Dover Downs as the IndyCars return for the first time in 30 years. We'll be right back.
So lap 43 of this race, we have our second caution. Watching the action with me here, Christopher Tate and Chris Goodwin. Christopher, I think the question for you is that what's really caught my eye, and I know you've admired it too, the way Stewart is just carving through this traffic. I mean, he's unbelievable, isn't he?
Yeah, at the top of the show, Chris called him the class of the field. And when you see him moving like that, and you see the others hesitating,
yeah,
understandable given the sort of accidents people are having today, but you see others hesitating, and Stewart's just taking high, taking low, running down onto the apron, up near the wall. The car's obviously rock solid, and he is very brave boy. I mean, this is great stuff.
But this is a self-perpetuating thing, because he feels good, he's driving well, and the confidence comes even more from that sort of thing, doesn't it?
Yes, and he's on a roll. He's the only guy to have won two races so far. Yeah. He's the reigning champion. Yeah. He's the points leader. I mean, everything's going right for him. I think we rate him very highly, and I mean, he's showing it in the way he's handling traffic. Wonderful.
Chris, it's not often you can actually see the man who's in form so clearly standing apart from the rest of the field, but this is one great example, isn't it, the way he does carve through the traffic.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just a sign of his confidence, really, and to be honest, that in itself is making his overtaking less hazardous, because all the other guys are hesitating, and the moment you hesitate, the guy you're overtaking hesitates and doesn't know where you're going. I think anyone that's about to be lapped by him knows exactly what's going to happen to him.
Yeah. Before the race started, we were talking about this track and the steepness of the banking, but in fact, even the straights aren't level. I mean, the thing is on an angle all the way round, isn't it? It's amazing.
Yeah, it's quite a vicious-looking circuit, and as you say, even the straight is at a very steep incline. And even on a conventional oval, the cars will be set up so that they won't drive in a straight line normally. They're set up to ease the cars around the left-handers. But with a banked straight, the guys will actually be having to put quite a lot of workload into the steering just to hold the cars in a straight line. So.
And Christopher, we noticed, don't we, now that it's going the way you feared it might be, a smallish field. They're starting to all fall by the wayside. We could be down to a few runners by the end.
Yeah, shame to see Engine go on dismal. That's a nicely prepared car, and he's been having a competent run. But we've got people out with accidents. We could be a little thin, but that's what make it worthwhile to get back in again if you can, if you've got a problem. Points and money paid all the way down the field, you may as well carry on running. But I think it'll still be quick at the front.
OK, let's just see if we can cross back now. We can get a race summary as the action progresses.
The man that started it off, Stewart, back up on the point again with three lead changes, and the speed way down from that 185 at which he qualified by these two caution periods, which are still extending now through 17 laps. And the cars, Jack Miller is out, Ward is out, and Harrington pulled out after lap one. Let's go to Dick Bergman.
I'm with Mark Dismore. He's been out of the car for about a minute and a half, and Mark, your heart is still pounding. How physical is it out there?
It's real physical, Dick. It's quite an aerobic workout, I'll tell you.
What happened to the engine? What caused it to fail?
Well, I think we broke a rod is what it felt like. I mean, I've lost a couple, and that's what it felt like happened. It probably lost a bearing and then rod let go.
Many of the mechanics this morning were saying that there's kind of three races here, a race to see if the engines are going to survive, the cars, or the drivers. In this case, the driver's fine, the engine's not.
Mark Dismore, one of the fastest in practice all weekend here at Dover Downs.
I'll tell you, they're fortunate if they lost a rod that it didn't go through the side of the block and then cause a lot more trouble for everybody.
That's true. Coming up next, CBS Sports begins its coverage of the Goodwill Games, live from Madison Square Garden in New York. In an international hoop fest, the USA and Puerto Rico square off. That's next. And later today at 4 p.m. Eastern, final round coverage of the Ameritech Senior Open from Long Grove, Illinois.
We got a restart.
Tony Stewart leads Eddie Cheever, Scott Sharp, Greg Ray, and Davey Hamilton. Robbie Unser is sixth on the restart. Ari Leyendyke, Buddy Lazier, Stefan Gregoire, and Raul Boisel.
Well, again, the big story, Cheever did not qualify that well, but you can see him running right towards the front of this pack. So he obviously has a better race car than he did a qualifying car.
Jim Guthrie back on track after a stay on pit road. And Cheever is doing a good job of hanging right with Tony Stewart.
He really is. Again, we can really see the white marks down the racetrack. Those are the places where they brought the grinder out to try to smooth this racetrack to make it a little less physical for these racetrackers.
Dick Bergman.
We were wondering about Eddie Cheever going so much faster. Owen Schneider, his chief mechanic, just looked at the lap times that they had put in until qualifying, and he said, this just isn't working. So they changed just about everything in the car. They changed springs, shocks, ride height, rear wing, base
basically they threw an entire new setup at the race car. They only had a few minutes to practice last night. It was good there. It's great today.
Cheever's last lap, the fastest I've seen on the board today, 181.4 miles per hour. And Greg Ray just ran a lap at 182. Wow.
Well, these are speeds that are faster than what they actually qualified at. And very rarely do we see that at any of the IndyCar races.
Greg Ray, 182 and a half last time by. He's the fourth place car at the top of your screen. That black machine with the orange helmet. It's dark green, actually. His own car is black. His Conseco car is dark green. He's subbing for injured Billy Boat. Second place race. Cheever has been caught by Scott Sharp.
Scott Sharp right there is putting more pressure than Cheever wants to see right now. This is inside Scott Sharp. So Scott now is really just sort of sizing him up, seeing where he's maybe a little stronger, where his weak points are in relationship to Cheever. Wow, inside, down, underneath, going in. Eddie must be leaving a little bit of room there because, again, he's as quick as anybody.
Cheever now being pressured by Greg Ray, right behind Scott Sharp. There's Cheever in the teal and black colored car, and that dark green of Greg Ray driving A.J. Foyt's car.
Done a nice job. You know, it took him a while throughout the weekend to get used to working with the new crew and working with A.J., but again, it's race time. It's time to press the button, and he's pressing it pretty good.
Ray qualified seventh. Now battles for third with Eddie Cheever.
It's interesting. Eddie was real good when the tires were cool. The thing's heating up. I can't tell yet if it's starting to get a little bit loose and he's having to roll out of the throttle a little more than he wants.
We could see the bumpiness in Greg Ray's car right there at the exit of turn two. The car really just jumps and then settles down from the downforce, but it's pretty violent transition.
Robbie Unser on the outside, the blue and yellow in the children's beverage group, and Lyandike going by for sixth place.
Ari Lyandike qualified back in 10th position. Had a time coming to grips with Dover. Now, Greg Ray draws a bead on Cheever, but Cheever's protecting that low line against Greg Ray. More on Greg Ray, here's Ralph.
The team knows that Billy is coming back in a couple of weeks and that Greg is going to go on to another ride. So when they worked on this car all weekend, they told Greg, all we want you to do is drive the car, tell us what you feel. We'll make the adjustments. They didn't want to give away any of their secrets with this car. So Greg Ray has no idea of any of the setups on this car. All he knows is it's handling better than it did the last time he was in the pit.
It's obvious he's put away the blindfold that Foyt's crew has had on him then. Remember, at Texas, Billy Boat really had to work to hold off Greg Ray to win that race. So.
Well, and actually, some drivers are better if they don't get into the engineering side of the race car. A lot of times, they don't need to know what springs and shocks and wing angles are in that thing, but they've got to be able, the driver's got to be able to tell the crew what the car's doing out there, where it's handling well, if it's understeering getting in and loose getting off. He's got to be able to communicate with that team so they can make the adjustments, and obviously it's worked.
Let's go out on the roof to Ken Squire.
Well, Robbie Unser's performance out here today came from 16th position on the starting grid as he rolls up through in Eddie Cheever's second car up into seventh spot, having an excellent run at the present time. Hart prepared car, the crew chief on the machine. Looks like he's going to go for the top five before this is over in that yellow and blue livery that you see right there. Mike?
Seventh right now, Ken, is race leader. Tony Stewart begins to come up into traffic. Davey Hamilton moving up. They're about to lap Raul Boisel. Remember, he was the leader at the restart, but one lap later, he decided to surrender the lead and pit, and now Boisel's in danger going a lap down.
Yeah, well, that just shows you what traffic will do. They were boxed up for the restart, but if you get trapped in traffic, it can really hinder your performance. This is looking out of the back of Boisel's car right here, and that's Stewart, again, sizing him up, looking for a place to go. He says, let me look down low. Boisel says, I like down low, too, so that ain't going to work for both of them.
Are you heard? He's just been told on the radio the leader's behind him. So hoping this favor gets returned someday, look to give a little room.
Well, either that or you try to drive a little bit harder to keep the leader behind you and hope you can catch a yellow that'll let you pack this up and make the adjustments on the race car.
Look at his hands on the steering wheel as we go down that straightaway.
Well, look at his head. Look at the head bob around. I mean, this whole area, there's just a lot of roughness in this racetrack. Now, when he gets on the front straightaway, the driver actually have to turn their wheel to the right a little bit to hold it up the banking. Very unusual. They're not used to that, and that surprised some of the drivers when they first came here.
Well, the straightaways here are banked steeper than the corners at Milwaukee, almost New Hampshire.
Yeah, and close to Indianapolis. There goes Stewart. Finally got by on the outside, so Bosell protected the inside, but Stewart said, I can't wait any longer.
Tony Stewart rockets through this field. Scott Sharp up for second. Eddie Cheever is third. Greg Ray is fourth. Fifth, Davey Hamilton. Sixth, Ari Leyendyke. Robbie Unser seventh, and here's the battle for eighth. Buddy Lazier in that purple number 91. And Stephane Gregoire right behind him.
Inside Buddy's car. See that thing shake? He fights the car in the corner. This is looking out of the back of Lazier to Stephane Gregoire, the Blue Star battery car. They've had a good weekend. Look how Stefan's able to keep the car down pretty tight, but now on the inside.
Car on the bottom. Car on the bottom.
That's Steve Knapp.
And the spotter, you heard the spotter try to warn him, but it was a little bit late. But again, that's Steve Knapp in the PDM car, and he's all over these guys.
And here comes Tony Stewart. There's your race leader, that yellow car, coming right in amongst this group.
Again, you can't be too careful in traffic when the leader's coming up on you. You got to get clear and try to get some ground. There's Stewart on the outside of Greg Wall.
Now he moves up on Lazier. Trying to put Lazier, the eighth place car, a lap down. Ralph?
Mike, don't forget that Tony Stewart is driving a G-Force chassis. It's the first time he's run one since Phoenix. He got his first career IRL win in this very chassis last year at Pikes Peak. The G-Force has less drag, which is exactly what you would want on this racetrack. Tony normally runs a Dallara, a better car for places such as Indianapolis, where you want really good downforce.
And his choice of the two chassis for here, they did a lot of testing.
Yeah, we got a car slow down that back straightaway right there.
Sammy Smith.
But you can see how Stewart just dominating the field right now. And it's amazing. It's one of the exciting things about the IRL is that you're able to go back and forth with different chassis for different racetracks. And the motors and everything adapt both one way and the other.
Sam Schmidt, the Formula 2000 graduate. On pit road. And coasting in. Scott Sharp having a tough time in the traffic. The report is that Schmidt was out of fuel, ran out of fuel. And he may not make it around to his pit. Now he's up on the banking trying to get a little coast down the hill.
Yeah, that's real bad timing where you're going to run out of fuel. He obviously had to go about the whole racetrack.
He's not going to make it. He's at the entrance of turn three, and it's a long way around to the pit lane. So after 77 laps, a number of them under caution. Schmidt trying to stretch his fuel to the next caution is unsuccessful. Tony Stewart has led all but 11 laps so far today, 77. 78 this time.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see what they got to do. Schmidt is not going to make it, so it'll be interesting to see when they throw the yellow to try to get him out of harm's way.
Stewart pulling up on Marco Greco once again.
Well, we got Cheever and Greg Ray right there. Ray is giving Cheever more pressure than he'd like right now.
Sam Schmidt's trying to bump it along on the starter motor, and they have waved the caution for Sam Schmidt.
Pits are closed. Car one, your leader is in turn three.
Now the pits are closed as the caution is waved, as you've heard. Schmidt can pit and add enough gas to get back around the racetrack without penalty, even though the pit lane is closed right now. CBS Sports coverage of the Pep Boys 400K continues after this message and a word from your local station.
You've probably been there on holiday.
Welcome to Spain.
You probably loved it.
The sand, sea,
beaches.
You probably adored the people.
bit mucky, a bit smelly.
Revolting.
You probably enjoyed their hobbies.
They chuck cows off buildings in there.
And you must have loved their food.
No traditional restaurant is complete without bull's testicles.
Relive your favourite holiday moments.
Goodness gracious, his balls are on fire.
Bloody Foreigners, tonight at 10, first on Sky One.
Some people, the path to buying a new car is full of uncertainties. But now we're introducing a simpler way to buy a new Ford. Simpler to choose the model you really want. Simpler to take it for a test drive. Simple, straightforward pricing. And a range of simple ways to pay. Experience simplicity. Call 0800 646464 to connect with Ford.
Why do you whisper green grass? Why tell the trees what ain't so?
Whispering. You can cut one third off UK calls on Saturdays in September. Call 0800 241424 now to register for BT's Chatterday Saturday.
Welcome back. Well, our colleagues at CBS in America are still on a commercial break. We'll be back with the action very soon. Just briefly, Christopher, just summarise for me, if you will, in simple terms, the difference between the two types of chassis in this race.
Well, the Dallara chassis has really been dominating in the whole IRL season to date, and Tony Stewart's been running one all season. For this track, and this track only, he's taken up his G-Force chassis again. There are three spec chassis in the
three,
whole series.
Yep.
The Riley and Scott, there's only one of those. And most people seem to be with the Dallara, and the G-Force is built in Sussex. And Tony Stewart is saying that he feels it runs through the air better on this particular circuit.
And the chassis can really be the key to success, can't it?
Absolutely. It's strong, too. That's the thing he's really after here on this concrete surface. And they know how to build them strong. They built Richard Noble's Thrust 2 land speed record car.
They sure did, yeah. Excellent. Well, thank you for that. I think we can now cross back to our colleagues in America. We're about a third of the way through the action, and let's now rejoin them at Dover Downs.
Scott Sharp, Tom Sneve up in the booth. Scott, we got to ask you a little bit about traffic. You got down in the apron, getting into the corner one time, battling for position. That was fun to watch. What was it like from your spot?
Well, Monk screwed up the Vecchio pretty good. Definitely not where you want to be. You know, close quarters and three cars in there. I wanted to get by Tony. I wasn't sure if he saw me. And I just used up a little extra road, I think.
One thing at a time, Scott.
Did it knock the car loose, or what did it do to the handling?
The minute he got down onto the apron, it pushed it right up the Venkman. Luckily, I think Cody saw that I was low, and he moved up a little as well.
How's the chassis other than that? I mean, how are you? You got something for Stewart in front of you?
You're going to go green this time, Scott. You're going to go green this time. Fuel to 96. Fuel to 96.
I don't know, Tom. I think we're just going to hang in there, keep riding, see what happens.
Good luck. Thanks, Scotty.
Going green this time.
Going to go green, Scotty. Going to go green. Get your fuel up to 96.
84 laps complete. Three cautions thus far today for 27 laps. Pace car stretches out the field at turn four. And Scott's going to try to get a jump on Tony Stewart here. He's coming. He's reeling Stewart. He's going to close right up within a car length and charge for the lead in turn one. Sharp's got him.
Great move. He got a little momentum on the restart. He's able to get after the throttle and got the job done.
Battle for third. Greg Ray.
Well, good battling here, side by side. Goodyear on the outside. He's a couple laps down, but he still wants to race with these guys.
Oh, Greg Ray almost got in the side of Cheever. Scott Goodyear lets the cars on the lead lap go by. Now, out in front of Scott Sharp, his Knapp back in 13th spot, four laps down, but he's just as fast as the leaders right now. That's Knapp ahead of Scott Sharp.
Again, this is inside Sharp's car. You can see him shuffle his hands around to get around this racetrack. This car looks like it might be a little bit softer suspended than some of the others we've been in car with, because he doesn't have the vibration, or we don't see the vibration that some of the other cars have.
Ralph?
Well, Mike, soft or not, he likes the way it is. He has made no adjustments to the chassis or handling of this race car. And that last stop, they just took tires and fuel. Crew Chief Mike Hornbass says they're very pleased with the handling of their race car.
And, Ralph, he has pulled away from Tony Stewart. Now, here's the third-place battle. Davey Hamilton in orange and silver, the Reebok colors, then Greg Ray and Eddie Cheever in teal, keeping close tabs on one another. Scott Sharp is really opening up a lead.
Well, that's pretty impressive, because we asked Scott if he had anything for Stewart, and he wasn't sure he did. But it goes to show you how close these cars are running, and being in the right traffic position and clean air really helps a car.
Closing in on 100 laps, Ken Squire.
When you watch this battle between Scott Sharp and Tony Stewart, remember, it's not just Dover, Delaware. This is for the Indianapolis Racing League Championship. Coming into the weekend, leading in the points with Stewart by 20. Picked up a few more by sitting on the pole. But the man in second spot is the driver of the number 8 Delphi Automotive car, qualified fourth, Scott Sharp, out of Connecticut, now leading. Back to Mike Joy.
Thanks, Ken. He's trying to pull up and put another lap on Knapp, and that's not going to be easy. Knapp lost 3 laps when he pitted under green, just a few laps before the second caution.
Yeah, we're not sure why he had to pit under the green, but Knapp qualified fourth. This PDM team is just ecstatic with the job that he's been doing for him. You can see he's about as quick as anybody.
It's only Steve Knapp's second start of the year. Of course, he was sensational at Indianapolis.
We've got Davey Hamilton in the Reebok, the orange car right here, and right behind him, Greg Ray is trying to find a way around.
They're pulling down on Stefan Gregoire, a lap down, and moving underneath now, Jim Guthrie.
Well, Cheever, you can see Cheever, the third guy in that, right after the green car is Eddie Cheever. So it's a pretty good battle right here between these three.
Dick Bergren.
Well, Tony Stewart came in on that last pit stop, and his pit stop was fast. Oh, we got a big crash on the front stretch. Big front stretch crash.
That's 99, Sam Schmidt. He pounded the wall down the front straightaway. And you see the whole right side is clean from that car.
Well, you can see that tire is still going to cause somebody trouble. But again, it just wiping the right side out. Spotters are trying to indicate where their cars need to go.
Now that would be there's the rear tire, I believe. He hit the wall, Tom, come right at the exit of turn number 4. The car swept up high and just pancaked the wall with the right side. Sam's moving around, and he's going to climb out.
Well, again, he was a little farther around the corner than the first incident we saw. Sam Durk stumbled a little bit, but he just nicked the left front.
Pit lane instead of the racetrack.
Well, since he and his dad own most of that car and equipment, that's going to be a devastating setback for Schmidt. Something must have broken on the car because it wiggled and then went up and shot into the wall.
Yeah, well, there's other owners now. There's probably people in the grandstand that own parts of that car now.
Schmidt is okay. They've had a pretty decent season, the races that they've been running at the finish. But he has 7 DNFs in 11 career IRL starts. Make that 8 for 12 now.
Okay.
If you'd been sitting on top of the wall, here's what you would have seen.
This is coming out of turn 4. Oh, the thing got sideways. The back end jumped loose, and he had to try to catch it.
We used to have a camera in that location. Not a cameraman, folks, but a camera. Mandatory trip to the infield care center for Sam Schmidt.
And you could see the car, the back end just stepped out on him big time. He tried to catch it, and by that time he's in the outside wall.
Bits and pieces, the access, front suspension access panel off the nose. And let's slow this down for you. It's hard to get a sense of the force of this impact at speed.
Again, you can see the car get sideways. He tried to correct it, and when he corrected it, turned it to the right. Boy, it just caught and snapped it up into the outside wall with the right front.
It shows, Tom, though, how far we've come in IndyCar construction with regards to safety. The suspension pieces compress, collapse, the tires do their job, and then all that right side pod does an awful lot to absorb impact.
Well, you can see there's not much left in the right side of that. You can see the tire bouncing across the racetrack, almost hitting the car again as he passed it one time. But again, self-cleaning, everything goes to the bottom.
Let's check with Ralph.
Mike, look at this. Here's one of the tires and pieces that came off of Schmidt's car. You can see the inside is still here. You can see all the suspension pieces as they broke upon impact. The outside of the wheel tire completely gone. A very, very heavy impact by Sam Schmidt. This was still on the racetrack. The track cleanup crew picked this up, just threw it over the wall to get it clean so they could get the other car still in the pace laps away. Look at the brake line still attached.
Again, the thing jumped sideways late in the corner. I mean, he's back into the throttle quite a bit of a few seconds, and so that there might have been something that broke in that car to snap it sideways like that because, again, he'd been back after the throttle for more than a few seconds on the exit of that corner.
But the best news is that Sam Schmidt is okay. Here's another look at it.
Just as the thing snaps sideways. But look at the debris that these other cars have to try to drive through at speed. Now, I talked to some of the guys last night. They'd say they'd rather drive through it than try to avoid it, especially down in the corner because the transition is so bad that they think they can get in more trouble by trying to dodge the pieces than they can by just driving through it.
Sam Schmidt's pulled up at the care center. Again, that's a mandatory trip for anyone in the Pep Boys Indy Racing League. If you're involved in an incident, you go to the care center to be checked out before you're released. That transition that Tom's talking about is from the 24-degree banking down to the track apron, which is essentially flat, and it's a very sharp drop there. It would look a lot like a curbing almost.
Well, and again, a lot of times the camera angle doesn't show it, but the racetrack goes down like this. When you get to the flat, it's a lot sharper angle than what it appears to be on our camera angles.
So we're under caution again for a bad crash here at Dover. Sam Schmidt is okay. Walked away, and we'll be right back to Dover Downs.
Well, hopefully you're enjoying our coverage, thanks to our colleagues in America, of the Pep Boys 400 from Dover Downs, watching the action with me here in the studio in London, Chris Goodwin and Christopher Tate. Christopher, first of all, your reaction to what we just saw. Sam Schmidt, a lucky man?
A very lucky man. That was a big accident, and it went on and on and on. I mean, from the end of turn four all the way up to turn one, there's debris all the way down the start-finish line. It's going to take some time to tidy that up. That was a big impact, and it hit
very
the wall
fast
hard.
And hard. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't quite see why he did that. I'd be interested in what Chris has to say. It looks to me as though that was something braking rather than driver error. But
yeah, Chris, you were making the point that's just about the area where there is a big bump, the sections of concrete.
It's very hard to say from the outside, but it did look as if it was roughly in the area where there is a bump, and it looked to me as if he was slightly running wide in the corner, maybe wider than he normally would have been already. And maybe the bump is a bit more severe there. But in any case, it looked like he was correcting a bit. And then all of a sudden, the car just got away from him. But the very fact that he was correcting a rear slide steered him straight into the wall.
Yes.
And that's one of the things I've been told that if I ever race on an oval circuit, if the rear of the car steps out, don't do the normal thing and correct too much into it, because you steer straight head first into the wall.
Now, one of the main problems with an incident like that is the amount of debris that's left on the track afterwards. And really, you were making the point, it's so essential to get everything off the track before you restart racing.
Absolutely. Not only is there a danger of, obviously, a car picking up a puncture at the speeds they're doing over 200 miles an hour down the straight, the car's being pressed into the road, so the slightest sharp object could shred a tyre.
Yeah, but I mean, you've only got to look at these pictures to know how much stuff is being left. There's bits all over the place, aren't there?
Oh, yeah, and you've got to understand that those bits and pieces are made up of either carbon fibre at best or worst, steel nuts and bolts, and if a small nut or bolt was flicked up by a car you were following at 200 miles an hour, it's not going to take much for that to go through your visor. So it's really important to get an absolutely clean racetrack before they start going quickly again.
Fine, I think we can now cross back to Dover Downs and rejoin the action.
Welcome back to Dover Downs. We are under caution for Sam Schmidt's crash coming out of turn number four. Schmidt just hit the wall hard. Now, Scott Sharp in the last run of green flag racing had opened up quite a lead on Tony Stewart. Let's go to Dick Bergeron in the pole sitter's pit.
Mike, the handling has gone away on Tony Stewart's car. In that last pit stop, they changed the tire combination on that race car. They also changed the nose wing. Stewart radioed back to his crew. It's worse. He's got a lot of onboard adjustments in that car. He's fooling with all of them, and he says to his team, do not worry. This car will be fine at the end of the race, even though Scott Sharp's faster than us right now.
Thanks, Dick. There is Scott Sharp, your race leader. Stewart lines up in second.
Well, we talked about the adjustments you can make on board. There's a bunch of things. They've got weight jackers that you can run on only one corner of the car, so you can change the weight from the left front to the right front. You can move the weight around 70, 80 pounds, and that sometimes can change the handling characteristic quite dramatically.
Late pit stops for Scott Goodyear, who is laps down, and Ari Leyendijk, who is on the lead lap. We're joined by Billy Vogt, who's back after that tough crash at New Hampshire. How's the leg mending up?
It's doing good. You know, I think my recovery's going well, and everything on progress, and I'm looking forward to getting back in the race car.
Does it twinge a little bit every time you see one of these guys hit the wall today?
We're back under green. We'll have Billy stay up with us for a bit and comment on what we're seeing here today at Dover as the IndyCars return here for the first time in 30 years. Scott Sharp in front of Tony Stewart on the restart. Greg Ray right there with Davey Hamilton, the orange car, and Eddie Cheever. Cheever dives underneath Hamilton and moves up a notch.
Well, Hamilton just had to wait. He's just trying to fit in. But, Billy, it's got to be tough to watch your car out there. It's fun to see that it's doing decent, but I'm sure you'd like to be in it. Oh, we got trouble. Ouch.
Turn two.
Wow.
A grinding crash out of turn two. Two cars involved.
That was Cheever on the outside that slammed the wall real hard.
And there's a car, two cars down to the inside. Cheever's shaking his fist at Greg Ray.
Well, and yeah, that's Greg Ray and Billy's car. They're both moving around trying to get out of these things, so they're all right. The one I'm surprised at is Cheever. Cheever's got to be stunned just a little bit because that thing hit the wall hard.
Go low on the back stretch. Slow it down. There's debris everywhere.
They were battling for third place. Make that fourth place behind Hamilton.
Well, this is Eddie Cheever right here. Again, to get out and to be able to reach down and feel if your leg's still there. I mean, there's not much left of that race car.
And Greg Ray in his first race for A.J. Foyt while battling Cheever for fourth.
Cheever, you can see, he's shaking his head a little bit. He thinks that maybe he wasn't the cause of that accident at this point.
It was hard to tell, really, what happened when they got together.
The best news is both drivers are okay.
Look at the look in Greg Ray's face. I mean,
I'm sure he's very disappointed because they had a great run going. You know, the Conseco car was working very well, and they were hanging right in there.
You can see he's trying to tell the safety workers he's fine, but I don't know. Did you see the eyes there? I mean, it looked like he was staring down Eddie Cheever. So obviously we have a little disagreement between these two of what caused this thing to start.
Cheever was waving his fist at Greg Ray even before the car came to rest. Now you're hearing Tom Steve and also Billy Vogt. When do you hope to be back in the seat?
I was hoping to be back for Charlotte, but they told me it's going to be Pikes Peak before I get back. So, you know, we'll just continue my rehabilitation and, you know, just keep working out and staying with it, and then I'll be ready for Pikes Peak.
I know you'd rather be in the car than standing up here with us, but what about what we're seeing here today? We've had Jeff Ward, we've had Sam Schmidt, and now these two cars just pound the wall here.
Well, I think, you know, this is a very tough place to run. It's very much high attrition, and we're looking at, you know, the guys are running close. I mean, I was up there watching them in the suite, and how close they're running is incredible. I think it would scare them if they knew how close they were running. So
we're looking at AJ, your owner, and obviously he's got to be a little discouraged at
this
point.
For the second race in a row, he has to take the ride to the care center to meet his driver.
I've seen that look on his face before. That's not a good look.
No, they didn't like that. The good news is we couldn't read Eddie Cheever's lips as he was walking away.
Yeah, that would be interesting to see that replay again.
Well, let's try to see.
This is inside Lazier's car right there. Well, again, you see them wheel to wheel, side by side. There's just not enough room.
No,
they're both fighting for the same spot and touch wheels. Again, from that angle, it didn't look nearly as severe as it did from the live angle, the other angle we saw.
Looked like they just ran out of racetrack. You know, Eddie was coming down, and the car on the bottom is naturally, you know, the gravity wants to take it up the bank, and they just ran out of room. It's very unfortunate.
It looked like Greg realized that he wasn't going to be able to get the pass done. He was actually trying to sneak back out of that situation. Right. And, you know, it doesn't take much of a wobble when they're running that close. But it's amazing these guys feel good enough to run that close to each other when they're running, you know, the speeds they're going on a mile over. Here they go. Again, you can see Eddie get slammed up into the wall.
Just kind of got the left rear there, and they both just went right straight into the fence. It's a... And then that inside, I tell you, that inside impact is just as bad as the first one, because you have to wait for that one coming. You see that one coming, and there's absolutely nothing you can do. So.
Well, it's a little bit like a blue light special, a two-for-one-er, you know.
Yeah.
You get the outside wall, and what's really bad about the outside wall, it tears all the suspension off, and there's nothing there on the, when you get to the inside wall to absorb the energy.
No, you don't have your brakes. You're steering, and you've got your foot on the brakes, and it's absolutely doing nothing.
Well, it looked like there's plenty of room for blame, and both drivers were gesturing and signaling to each other their disapproval.
Here it is again. Right in the bottom, you see Greg wiggle a little bit right in the middle, but they get through that, and again, they come together.
Yeah. It did not look to me like Greg Ray pushed very much up the racetrack.
No, but he did. Just before they made contact, Gray wiggled. He's down low trying to get by Eddie, and the car wiggled.
Looks like it wiggles over that bump.
When it wiggled, he sort of backed out.
Those wall-mounted cameras are earning their pay today, overtime.
Well, the drivers are taking a beating and earning their pay today, too.
Dick Berggren.
Well, Tony Stewart's problems just got a whole lot worse. A few laps ago, he radioed to his crew that the corner of the dashboard was flopping down. A few laps after that, the whole dashboard fell into his lap. So he is here on pit road. They're taping the dashboard back into position. The great worry is, what would happen if one of the wires there might short out or might fail? That could cause a problem with the engine or some other component in the race car. Stewart's back on the speedway. He is at the tail end of the lead lap.
What's amazing is they've changed a lot of parts on that car, put new wing, new components on it, because they knew how stressful this racetrack is on the different suspension pieces. But I don't think they thought the dashboard would fall out of the thing because of the racetrack.
Here's the top of that suspension cover gone. One car, number 81. Here's our Aflac trivia question of the day. Two drivers are tied for the most career IRL wins. Who are they? Give you a hint, it's three wins apiece. We'll have the answer for you in a moment. We're under caution at Dover Downs International Speedway as the IndyCars return. We'll be right back.
Well, this is certainly a race with plenty of incident, a lot for us to discuss here in the studio in London. Greg Ray and Eddie Cheever, that was a potentially very nasty accident, Christopher. And again, we have to say, these cars are so strong.
Well, I mean, the way they come apart to dissipate all the energy is the key to the thing, leaving you in the central safety cell. There didn't appear to be much left of Cheever's car, did there? But, I mean, that was a big smash. And if you watch here, the impact into the wall, pressed up against the wall by Greg Ray's car. No wonder the guys on the pit lane were scattering, because that car was just breaking up all over the place.
Yeah.
And nice to see them both safe, but they look cross with each other.
I suspect a few words may be exchanged, if not blows. They're obviously not happy, but thankfully, as you say, they're unscathed. But Chris, you were making the point, weren't you, that probably really just a racing incident. You wouldn't actually say Eddie was at fault there.
Well, his only fault really was the fact that he didn't necessarily give Greg Ray more than enough room, which you should really do in that sort of situation. He gave him just enough room, but unfortunately at the moment he gave him just enough room, Greg needed a bit more.
But what we're saying is that's because they're on a very different type of track this week to what they're normally used to, and he's maybe hasn't taken that into account.
Absolutely. Some of the oval circuits they're racing on are much smoother, more predictable through the corners. There's a lot more room through the bends anyway. But, you know, here they're actually fighting to keep the cars stable through the corner. And I think at the moment that where they were inches apart, it looked as if Greg Ray just had a slight wiggle, maybe hit one of the bumps in slightly an awkward position. And he just moved slightly and they touched wheels, just touched them very gently. But that's enough to cause a big accident.
Christopher, we have a feeling, don't we, this could be quite a long delay because there's an awful lot of debris. We discussed that a moment ago. There is now plenty of that on the track.
There's a lot of sweeping up to do, and it will take a little while, I feel. I think the interesting thing here about Greg Ray is, you know, he's not got a lot of experience. And Cheever's experience may in some way have played against him in this accident, because Eddie's so used to the way they come smoothly off the transition of a normal banked corner onto a flat straightaway. Here at Dover Downs, we've got a 9-degree bank on the start-finish line, so they're coming down from 24 degrees to 9 degrees, and I think Cheever just got a bit chopped out, didn't give him enough room.
Christopher, thank you for that. We're now going to go back to Dover Downs. We've got a summary of the race so far from our colleagues at CBS.
Retired from the event, Ray and Cheever, the latest after this sensational incident in turn two. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Eddie Cheever is out of the infield care center. Eddie, what happened between you and Greg Ray?
There was a pile of cars up ahead of us, and they were slow. He got caught up in traffic. I went around the outside. I was completely clear. Have no idea. It would have been a move if I'd have done with somebody a little bit more experience. Would not have been a problem. He probably panicked, lost some air in the front, and just ran into the side of me. And, I mean, he was past. I was gone. I was past him, and I was already looking down the straightaway. So I don't know what happened. Very frustrating. Stupid move. Very stupid move. When you're driving that close, you can't give up an inch one way or the other. So we had been passing a lot of times, and I got passed by Stewart. And passed other people. It was just unfortunate. That's part of his learning experience, I guess.
You shook your fist at him after the wreck. Did you get a chance to talk to him in the infield care center?
He should sit down and look at the screen and have a little idea of what was going on. I mean, on a track like this, especially when you're in traffic, you pass high, you pass low, you pass every chance that you get. So when there was a group, there was an opportunity to go around the outside. I took it. I got all the way around. I'm straight, and all of a sudden I got hit from behind. There was no doubt in my mind who did it, because that was the only car on the inside. I'm particularly angry. It's very dangerous. It's not uncalled for.
Eddie Cheever's car is hauled off to the garage area. Mike Joy with Tom Sneva and Billy Vogt joins us. The winner in Texas and off to a fine run in New Hampshire when you got caught up in one of those accidents not of your own making. We're going to show it here and
Absolutely. Kind
of have you describe what happened to us, to you up there in New Hampshire.
You can see right here, J.J. Yale gets loose, and I'm going to go around the outside of him. And then right there I get tagged, and not really a big deal. You know, I get the wall right there, but then I lose the steering, and the car comes back across the track, and then right there where Al Boisel gets in the side of me. And you can't really see the impact, but the nose of his car is lodged right in the side of mine right now, and it actually went in about 10 inches into my car and was laying in my lap, and it's something I'll never forget, a pretty painful incident. But I've really got to give a hand to the IRL medical crew. You know, they did a great job of getting me out of the car, and, you know, Dr. Bach, they flew me back to Indy and took care of me there. And, you know, those guys did a great job, and I feel real lucky.
It was pretty interesting. It looked like you almost cleared the whole situation, but just got nipped, and the outside wall really didn't do much damage.
No damage at all. It was just all that impact right there, right at the end, and, you know, just some unfortunate deal.
Watching Ari Leyendijk pitting. Billy, glad to hear that you're okay and on the mend and going to be back with us in Colorado Springs. Thanks for stopping by.
Thank you.
Ralph Shaheen.
Unfortunately, Mike, this infield care center has been pretty busy. Sam Schmidt out now. Sam, what happened to you?
Well, I'd like to see the tape myself because I'm just not sure. I mean, the first set of tires were fantastic, and unfortunately, we started so far back that we, you know, just didn't really have a chance. Just trying to bide our time. We knew attrition would be a problem, and just this last set of tires just seemed something was different with the car, and it was just kind of vicious. And then coming through four, it just seemed like something broke, and the back end snapped around. So, I mean, I have no idea what happened. We were just trying to ride it out that set of tires, and I'm just not quite sure. You know, it got me puzzled. I guess Lord just didn't want it to happen today.
How tough is this track on these cars, the pieces and parts?
I really don't think it's any problem with the track. You know, I mean, it's no different than the loads are no different than Texas or Charlotte or any place like that. And we really, I mean, everybody had their shock styled. I hadn't heard anybody complain about the bumps. You know, it's just one of those deals. And if anything, it's just a little narrow with what happened to Greg and Eddie. There's just not a whole lot of room at 180 miles an hour to make corrections. So it's, you know, people were really being conscientious out there though and giving people room. So I didn't expect this to be this bad.
Thanks, Sam.
On the pit stop, the left rear tire changer for Ari Leyendijk knocked down in the move through the pits here.
Well, here's a replay of it. Left rear right here. The car is actually let down before he gets the wrench back on it.
Oh,
he got tangled in the hose.
trying to push the car away. Got tripped up there.
Well, again, he's behind most of the serious stuff, so that didn't look like it should have been too serious. It's behind the race car, so at least the race car didn't get him.
He's okay. All right, Tom, who are the two drivers that are tied for the most career IRL wins with three apiece?
Well, I think you got to put Tony Stewart in there somewhere.
And sure,
I'm going to give somebody else the opportunity to...
Here's a hint. Look at the screen. There's a hint.
I wanted to give somebody else the chance to put Ari in that second position.
Ari Leyendijk and Tony Stewart have three Pep Boys Indy Racing League wins. Cleaning up from the crash between Eddie Cheever and Greg Ray while racing for fourth spot. We'll be right back to Dover.
With the World Cup over, two missed their chance to shine on the world's greatest stage. Shearer, Gascoigne. For them, retribution begins here. Newcastle, Empoli, Benfica and Middlesbrough battle it out for the JD Sports Cup, coming soon on Sky Sports 2.
Everyone knows the old rules of photography.
Hope that's the right film for direct sunlight.
But Kodak Gold Ultra breaks them all.
Using the same film in here.
Kodak Gold Ultra performs brilliantly in almost all conditions. If this film isn't in your camera, imagine the pictures you'd miss. Kodak Gold Ultra. Film for all conditions.
Is now offering air conditioning for a cool £1 on selected Fiat Bravos, Fiat Bravas, Marais and Marais weekends.
Oh no, how are we going to sort this lot out?
Don't worry, Mr. Jones.
All these other insurance companies.
We'll do all that.
I'll have to take a day off going around garages getting estimates.
No, leave that to us.
But we still have to get it picked up.
No, we'll get it picked up. No problem.
When do we have to come and get it?
Don't worry. We'll deliver it back for you.
I wonder if it'll be...
cleaned inside and out and looking like new.
Well, it certainly looks good.
It's better than that, Mr. Jones. All the work is covered by a 3-year guarantee.
For easy, low-cost motor insurance...
Better talk direct. To Direct Line.
Susan Oliver is very partial to a bacon sandwich. But not just any bacon sandwich. Oh, no. The bacon has to be very, very crisp. The sauce has to be very, very brown. And the bread has to be very, very white. She admits to being a bit of a perfectionist, does our Susie. Must be the way she was raised.
Consider yourself at home.
Consider yourself one of the family. We take to you so strong. It's clear we're going to get along.
Consider yourself part of the furniture. Consider yourself our mate. We don't want to have no fuss.
Whatever your financial needs, there's a place you know you can trust. No wonder over 20 million people now consider themselves part of the Halifax.
Consider yourself one of us.
Feeding time!
Keep on running. Flash poser. Can't resist 3 for 2s. Love boots.
Welcome back. You're watching the action from the Pep Boys 400 at Dover Downs on the eastern seaboard of the USA. And we can now go back to the racetrack, catch up on an interview with one of the key drivers there.
Greg, what happened out there? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. It's just it's very disappointing to be in AJ's car and running for Conseco here. We had a pretty good car and we were working our way up to the pack. We started seventh and right then we were running in second. You know, I really think we're one of the fastest cars on the racetrack. And earlier that session, Eddie Cheever was blocking me, and I'd back up and I'd run on him, and I was 4/10 a lap faster than he was. And on that restart, he tried to take a flyer on the outside on the second lap, and he squeezed me down. I hit the apron, and I gathered the car up after that, but he just didn't give me enough room at the exit, and he cost us both the race. I mean, it's really disappointing. We're just barely, not even halfway, and that's just uncalled for.
Apparently a difference of opinion, Mike.
Sure is. One that'll be
well, that interview recorded
after.
Just a few seconds ago with Greg Ray. We've already, of course, heard from Eddie Cheever, but we can now go back live to Dover Downs, pick up the action as we join our colleagues at CBS.
Coasting to a halt.
Yeah, a little smoke here. That's just fuel gathering up. The motor stopped a lot quicker than the fuel injection system did, and so that's just some fuel burning off there.
We just crossed halfway, and Scott Sharp is the man at the front. Wilton, Connecticut native. Go-karter, sports car national champion. IMSA World sports car driver, and now IndyCar racer.
Well, and it's the Kelly Automotive Group. Here's Scott Goodyear that we saw had the problem earlier. Again, when you're five laps down early, you think you're pretty much out of the race. But with this kind of attrition, he still could be a factor.
He is. He's the 11th place car. Dick Berggren.
Moisel is in the process of getting out of his race car right now. There's a lot of fluid gear all over the ground. Smoke pouring out of the area where the radiators are. A disappointing day. He has run very fast in practice and thought he might have one of his career best days here at Dover, but it will not be.
Stewart going around the outside of Robbie Unser in the beverage group car.
That's third place for Tony Stewart now. Working up on Knapp, the ninth place car. And Gregoire. Gregoire is seventh.
See, Tony, this is where a driver really smiles. When the car works this good, he can go high, he can go low, he can take it where he needs to take it to get the job done.
Passing flag working on the driver's a lap down, but Gregoire holds onto that bottom lane.
Well, the big question is Tony having to hold the dashboard up with his knees to get around the racetrack?
They do a lot of testing with race car chassis, but I don't imagine, Tom, they do a lot of vibration testing with the whole car. Perhaps after this race, they'll start.
Well, I'd say the Monster Mile is pretty much an industrial-strength vibrator at this point.
It has knocked the dashboard loose on Tony Stewart's car, and it has gobbled several cars, starting with Jeff Ward. Into that wall, Jeff Ward, Sam Schmidt. And then the Cheever Ray incident, which took out two cars contending for third place. Now, look at the vibration on the steering wheel of Buddy Lazier. Compare that to Scott Sharp, whose wheel was relatively calm.
Right, and Buddy hasn't been happy with the car. They've not only been a little bit off the pace, a little bit slow, but they were concerned about fuel mileage. And those two don't normally go hand in hand. If you're slow, you usually get good fuel mileage. So this team's really been scratching their head, and obviously still didn't quite catch the setup for the Monster Mile.
Now, the way his head's bouncing around, is that vibration from the surface? Is that air flow over the helmet? Which?
No, at Indianapolis it might be airflow, but here I'm pretty sure it's the surface and wow. And the roughness of the racetrack. But again, we can adapt these cars to any condition. I mean, this is a little rougher than some places, but that's why they put a couple different pedals in the car.
Boy, Tony Stewart just went underneath Davey Hamilton and did not leave a lot of room. He's up to second place. They have made that car faster than it was in the last green flag run. He's just sped away from Hamilton.
Well, Davey, again, running second. You know, he's not very far off the pace, but you got to run on him down the back straightaway, some clean air, and made that pass look pretty easy.
But Stewart has had to come up through all this traffic, and it's allowed Scott Sharp to open up a lead of more than half a lap. They're not running too far apart on speed. Sharp's last two laps have been in the 181 and a half mile an hour bracket. Stewart right at 181 miles an hour.
Well, we saw him a little while ago. They were both together, and we thought actually Stewart would have a little bit for Sharp, but Sharp went on by and it maintained. Stewart didn't have anything for him. Again, they probably haven't been able to adjust the chassis like they wanted to, meaning Stewart on the last few pit stops, because they've been addressing the dashboard problem.
Well, let's find out. Let's go to his pit. Here's Ralph.
I'm with team manager Larry Curry. Larry, you spent so much time fixing problems with this car. Have you dialed it into where you want it?
Well, we had a problem with the dash profile.
Ralph, we should point out that even though Jeff Ward and Sam Schmidt had hard crashes into the wall, that also swept up Jack Miller was involved there, and Eddie Cheever and Greg Ray crashed hard together. Everyone that has gone to the Infield Care Center has been released. There are no injuries reported, which is the best news we can pass along.
Well, it talks a little bit about the safety and the advancements they've made. You know, there was some concern last year, but the IRL's addressed these problems, and these cars are a lot better this year than they were last year.
Dick Berggren?
Mike Corbett, this is Scott Sharp's crew chief. You got a guy closing in on you. Can you hold off Stewart?
I think we can. So far, we got a really good car out there. He's comfortable. He's a little bumpy, but he's there for the long run.
Well, this is a good guy and a good car to have for a racetrack with a lot of attrition. These guys have completed more laps this year than anybody else. Mike?
Thanks, Dick. Now, look at Scott Sharp, Tom, and look at the contrast between the way he sits in the cockpit and Buddy Lazier.
Well, and this is with him on the back of Leyendyke. This is Leyendyke right up here in front. Now, if there's going to be air turbulence, that should be compounded by getting up close behind Leyendyke. So you can see that it's the racetrack that's causing most of the stress on these guys rather than the aerodynamic part. But Leyendyke, one of the quicker cars. Let's see how long it's going to take Sharp to find a way to get by this situation.
And would you say from the lack of vibration that Sharp's car is perhaps sprung more softly than Lazier's?
Yeah, the shock and spring combination, I would say, is a lot softer than what we're seeing inside the Lazier car. And again, on a rough racetrack, Sharp's quite a bit quicker, so maybe somebody's going to learn something from this.
You're riding with the race leader, Scott Sharp, here at Dover Downs, Delaware. He will pit in five laps. We'll be back for that. 145 complete here at Dover Downs with the Pep Boys Indy Racing League. We'll be right back.
So just over 100 laps of that circuit still to go. The Monster Mile really is taking its toll now. Let's just go to our guest here in the studio in London. Chris, I know you want to talk about the physical battle that the drivers face on a circuit like this, especially somebody like Buddy Lazier. We had a terrific shot a moment ago of him really wrestling with the wheel all the way around the circuit. I don't know if it's his particular chassis, but it's hard work, this, isn't it?
Yeah, it's hard work for a number of reasons. Not only we can see here the car, whole car shaking around, which makes it harder work for him just to hang on to the wheel and steer the thing around the corners, but it's an indication of how well sorted the team is with the car. They haven't found as good a setup as the race leaders. The springs and dampers on the car aren't absorbing the bumps as well, so there's less stability, less grip, so he's having to work harder to just get around the corners at the same speed. Well, he's slower, in fact. The whole thing makes it a lot harder work, so the switched-on teams make it easier for the drivers, they make the car faster, and that's what it's all about.
It's impossible for the armchair spectator at home, or somebody like myself, to actually envisage what those drivers go through. I mean, at the end of a race like this, they must be physically, as you said, exhausted.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard work. They're actually looking at the way they're driving. They're in a constant corner around that circuit, so there really is no point at which, A, they can relax, but also where they can actually just relax their muscles. So their arms and shoulders are going to be hanging on and really putting a lot of effort into the steering all the time.
And the G-force on the head and shoulders and neck alone must be enormous.
Yeah, absolutely. You see the size of the necks. Next time we see an interview with one of the drivers, they won't have a neck. Their head will just go straight to the shoulders.
Know. They've got to be so fit. And the other fascinating thing we've seen just briefly in this race, Christopher, the communication. I mean, you know, how soon are we going to be able to hear Formula One drivers talking like some of these guys do to the TV fellas?
Yeah, it makes for really great stuff. Only under a yellow to be able to ask them, that sort of thing. You're not going to get them talking in full race speeds, but it makes just the whole spectacle that much more real. Terrific.
It sure does, but having said all that, we can now see there's more incident at the track, even as we were speaking. There's some other problem. Let's now see if we can return and find out what's happening.
The year at Indy was having a fine run here. A green flag pit stop dropped him down three laps off the leader, but he was coming back and was in eighth place.
Yeah, they're doing a tremendous job. Steve was doing an outstanding job. The crew was extremely happy all weekend with Steve in the car, and it looks like they're working on it a little bit. He's a little taller. He's a tall guy compared to a lot of these drivers. And again, there looks like they're working a little bit to get Steve out of that race car.
Now, when the caution came out, Scott Sharp was on pit road, and per the IRL rules, if you are past the entrance to pit road, you are okay to go and complete your pit stop. So he is done with his stop. The rest of the cars on the lead lap will likely pit during this caution when the pits open.
Middle of the track, pace car.
So Mel Harder, IRL Control on the radio. And here's Ralph.
Mike, problems for Davey Hamilton. First off, the car had gotten very loose. That's why Tony Stewart whistled on past him. Then, as they were holding on, waiting for their pit stop to tighten up the car, suddenly the car started to lose power. They are changing the black box on the car right now, hoping that that will restore the big power back to this race machine.
But actually, Davey, this crew came into the pits actually before the pits were open, but they needed to address this problem, get as much time as they could to try to solve that problem.
And the pit stop was approved. We heard on the IRL radio that it was approved for him to pit. The way this rule works, Tom, they close the pits when the caution is out. That's so that the field can be gathered up by the pace car and then everyone pit at a safe speed. But if a car is either already in the pit lane or has a problem, they are allowed to pit, but just to address the problem. Then they have to go back out and then pit in sequence with the rest of the cars.
Yeah, and it's really a great rule from a safety standpoint. When the pits were open under the yellow, we were forced or actually raced to get into the pits. And the yellow's out because you need to slow the cars down. There's a problem out there. So I think it's been a great change and has helped the safety of the sport.
Robbie Unser is on pit road, and Scott Sharp's pit stop allowed Buddy Lazier to get back up on the lead lap. As he came around under green and passed Sharp in the pit, Sharp was the race leader. Well, let's have a look and see if we can figure out what happened to Steve Knapp at turn two.
Again, this is coming out of turn two. They come up the hill. Oh, he's in trouble way back in the corner. Right here he got in trouble. So something obviously broke entering the corner. And you know, when it breaks at that point on the entry, you get a good long run at the wall, and that's not what the driver wants to see.
The car came around and hit left side.
Well, it definitely did, so it broke real early getting in. It maybe did 360. That sometimes that can help. You scrub off some speed, and that can be a benefit to the driver. Yeah, you can see him right there. You can see Steve. They're pulling him out.
And we'll get an update on Steve Knapp for you just as soon as we can. Most of the leaders have made pit stops. Tony Stewart, ahead of Ari Leyendyke, Scott Sharp, Buddy Lazier, Robbie Unser.
And they got the backboard. They put the backboard in behind Steve. And if there's any chance at all, what the safety guys do is they get that backboard on him, which tries to immobilize the neck and the back so you don't compound any problems trying to get the driver out. So it's really a safety procedure, and it's sort of a good sign because he is awake and they're not in a big rush to get him anywhere. So
Knapp making only his second start of the season. He was third at Indianapolis, a most impressive rookie debut, named rookie of the race in this year's Indy 500, and have a very strong run here. They got a few laps down and then came back up through the field, was running seventh at the time of this crash in turn two. Jeff Ward hit the wall in turn three. Sam Schmidt coming out of turn four. Eddie Cheever and Greg Ray crashed at turn two, and now this incident.
Well, again, he's up against the wall. We see that real late.
I'll show you Ari Leyendyke's view of what happened.
From the in-car camera. This is down the front straightaway. And you can see in front of him, the car just jumped sideways and backed into the wall, left side first. Again, Leyendyke was close enough to it. As he went to the wall, Leyendyke had no trouble getting underneath.
Similar to Sam Schmidt's crash, except Luce going into the corner instead of coming out. 154 laps complete. CBS Sports coverage of the Pep Boys 400K continues after this message and a word from your local station.
Well, it does appear, doesn't it, thankfully, that Steve Knapp is okay. At least he's out of the car. We'll obviously update you, as our colleagues will, at the track as soon as we have any definite information about him. But a mystery incident in some ways, boys. And I think we're going to say, Chris, aren't we, it could yet again be a case of mechanical failure, because the car suddenly seemed to just lose it and go into the wall.
Well, we only had a very brief glimpse of what happened, but the incident happened very early in the corner.
Yeah.
And from the onboard shot from the car behind there, it looked as though the car broke away very, very suddenly. So
yes.
It didn't look as if he was in any trouble controlling the car before he actually suddenly speared offline.
Do you get the impression that he was knocked out by the impact when he hit the wall? It stunned him.
Well, it looked as though he certainly hit the wall backwards, and so he doesn't look like he's incurred any injury to himself. But when you go backwards into a wall
at that sort of speed,
it's quite a sudden shock. And you know, I've actually had the same sort of
similar sort of
myself.
Thing. Yeah. Well, thankfully you're here to tell the tale. But Christopher, this is another maybe an indictment against this circuit. It's so demanding, so rough, and so bumpy. Cars are literally falling apart.
Well, as we've been watching these last few laps particularly, I'm beginning to get a little bit worried. We've now had 7 major hits into the wall. The Cheever Ray incident was their own fault. They were getting together.
Yep.
We think a number of things are broken. I don't know, the IRL's going to have to look very carefully at this circuit. Mm. See, the thing about that area, Baltimore, Washington area, it gets cold in the winter, and you're getting winter damage to this surface.
The surface breaking
the
up surface, and getting rough.
The surface was last laid in 1995, so it's had 3 hard winters since then, and it is bumpy, and I agree with Chris. It looked as though something broke under that consistent pounding and had poor Steve Knapp into the wall.
You were making the point as the race was progressing that the NASCAR boys can't believe the speeds these fellas are doing.
Yeah.
And actually, this is testimony to their bravery and indeed the technological skills of these guys and the teams, that they can race at that sort of speed around a track as tough as this.
Yeah, they've been doing 2 NASCAR races here for 25 years. And it's always exciting. It's always a very crowded field. But they're lapping average around 155. Yeah. These boys are now in the race doing 175, qualifying 185. That's quick.
Let's go back to the incident itself. We can now take that view from on board. And it really does reveal, doesn't it, that the car in question just suddenly goes into the wall.
Well, we think that looked there as though the whole back end just suddenly sat down onto the tarmac, and that's what accounted for that great puff of smoke, which wasn't just tire smoke, that looked like engine smoke as well.
Yeah.
And I think the bottom just smacked into the ground, don't you?
Yeah.
And he just turned himself into the wall, and that's a breakage, and that's a worry, and that's a worry about this circuit.
Okay, fine. Thank you, boys, very much indeed. We'll be back with you soon. Hopefully we can now cross back to the track and rejoin our colleagues with the race summary.
4 leaders have swapped that point position, and 7 lead changes, and there you see the big story. Although they can turn this track at 180 miles per hour, average speed is only 102. 6 cautions, and the latest is for number 18, Steve Knapp, who crashes in turn 2, right where we saw Ray and Cheever in trouble not too long ago. Cleanup continues down here in the turn 2 area of the Monster Mile, which continues to gobble up competitors today.
It's gobbling whole race teams, Ken. It's been quite a day. Let's have another look here. Tom Sneed will take us through this from Ari Leyendijk's car.
This is inside Leyendijk's car. Again, right here is Steve Knapp. There's 1 car in between Leyendijk and the trouble. The back end just jumps sideways on him, jumps out. The car backs up into the wall, left rear first. If there was good news, the only good news would be that, you know, the driver, when you back him in, he doesn't get to see the crash.
There's a look at Knapp's car, and you can see the left side pretty well cleaned off it here, as Knapp's car is hauled away. Joining us, Governor Tom Carper, governor of the state of Delaware. You and your sons, big NASCAR fans here at the Monster Mile. But
when that car spun around like that and he hit the wall, that reminded me of my old Corvair Monza, the first car. I used to do that.
They had trailing throttle oversteer. You lift the gas and away you go. Fortunately, we're a little more sophisticated with these now. What do you think of your first trip to IndyCar racing?
The most exciting thing I've done as governor, I've been governor 5.5 years, the most exciting thing I've done is to drive a stock car around this track about 130 miles an hour. hour. And the idea that these guys are going around 180 miles an hour is just awesome. My boys are 8 and 9. They're just next door. And they think this is pretty exciting. And
thanks
frankly,
for visiting.
So do I. You bet. We're glad that you're here. We're all excited to see
thanks for having us. You know, there's a little politics in racing every once in a while also.
We'll look forward to that speed limit in Delaware being raised to 130 miles an hour sometime soon.
Well, I remind you when I became governor, I was a congressman for 10 years. And my first year or so were period of adjustment, and I think maybe that's what we're going through here as well.
Perhaps so.
It's a tough learning curve sometimes when you go to a new racetrack for the first time.
Well, we'll get there.
Ari Lyandike completes his pit stop and rolls back out.
Copy.
As we work this caution flag for Steve Knapp's accident.
We have nothing. We have changed since lap 110.
Through the incident scene at turn two, and they're working them way around the debris that's being cleaned up now and to rejoin the field. Nobody covers racing like CBS Sports Line. You get the latest news and standings from the track, in-depth columns and driver bios, plus video highlights, interviews, and more. Get on the fast track at cbs.sportsline.com. They look like cops. They talk like cops. They're not cops, but they don't need a warrant to break into your home.
Well, while our colleagues at CBS continue their own promotions, we'll just discuss the race so far. Don't worry, if there is any action, we'll go straight back. Christopher, what do you make of this race so far? Well, it seems a while since we discussed what's actually happening in the race, doesn't it?
There's been so much incident going on, and we've been so fascinating by breakages in the cars and so on, the state of the track. Yeah, we slightly lost track of it. We were just saying, watching there, Ari Lyandike's looking quite strong, quite fancy him. But I don't know, we've got some lot of laps yet to do, and I'd be very surprised. We're not going to have very many finishes. I mean, look for just 6 or 7 or 8 finishes, I reckon.
No, we're certainly a long way to go. I mean, we're behind schedule here. This race is taking a lot longer, plenty of incident, and really, Chris, it's becoming a battle of attrition. We thought this would be short, sharp and furious, but it's actually turning out to be some real task here, isn't it?
It certainly is, but having said that we're losing cars and we could end up at the end of the race with very few cars on the road, it only takes two cars to make a race, and you've got these two young guys at the head of the field, Scott Sharp and Tony Stewart there.
Yeah.
And they look like they're going to have a battle through to the end of the race, and it could be pretty entertaining.
Stewart, do you think they've sorted his problems out? He looked so good early on, then he lost the lead, but what do you reckon?
Well, let's see what they're doing here. Fitting some new tyres. They're not new, they're scrub tyres, so maybe they're doing their trick of swapping the stagger arrangement on the tyres to change the handling. Just missed a car there. But, you know, they take the opportunity of these yellow flags incidents to come in and make slight adjustments to the cars. And a slight adjustment to a car that laps at over 180 miles an hour can make quite a big difference to the balance of the thing, which, bearing in mind, they've got long distances to...
Okay, let's hear now what's coming from Dover Downs.
He'll rejoin the field as Steve Knapp is going to be airlifted from the speedway. There is no tunnel at Dover for the ambulance to drive out, so they will airlift him from the racetrack to the hospital, and we'll give you further word when it's available. Getting set for the restart in one lap here. Scott Sharp, Buddy Lazier, Robbie Unser, Tony Stewart, and Ari Lyandike are the lead lap cars. Sixth is Stefan Gregoire, then Davey Hamilton, Marco Greco, Scott Goodyear, and Jim Guthrie. He is 10th. See that Steve Knapp has been stabilized there. The collar around his neck and head area, and being taken to the helicopter to be airlifted for treatment.
You can hear in the background radio, that's IRL, trying to let everybody know what to do, where the cars need to fit in, and how to get in line.
Moving Davey Hamilton to the back of the line. And it may have been because of a stop before the pits were open, and they did more than what was necessary to just run the car. We'll see. Scott Sharp rolls away from this field. He now has Buddy Lazier, who, remember, got back on the lead lap because Sharp was on pit road when the caution came out. Lazier is now the second-place car. Robbie Unser right behind him in third, and it's several cars back to Tony Stewart.
Well, there's Robbie Unser. They've done a nice job. Robbie uses his head. He's, you know, he's got the same mentality as Bobby, his dad, and he does a great job for a kid that's a rookie in IndyCar racing.
Unser runs in third. Now Hamilton is now shown as two laps down.
Hamlin's two laps lost on pit road, trying to make repairs to baby Hamilton's car.
Well, we can see Lazier in second, the blue car back here, right there. Buddy was off the pace early, took some advantage of the yellow situations, made adjustments in the car. With all these yellows, they've been able to make a lot of adjustments to the car, and you can see that Sharp is not running away from Lazier like he did earlier in the race.
Makes a good case for being a couple laps down, not giving up on it, and coming right back to the front because the leader was in the pits when the caution came out. You see him take his left hand on the wheel, off the wheel there, just kind of squeeze it, get some circulation going?
Well, they don't have much time, and so anytime you can try to give it a moment of rest, that's what they try to do. If you hear the engine noise, you can hear the motor isn't changing pitch too much. They're using a lot of pedal angle.
Tom, I got to wonder, do you primarily steer with your right, pull with your left hand, or push across with your right hand?
Drivers are obviously different. You can see him flexing the right and the left down the straightaway. He did that at Indy, too, but you have a lot more time at a place like Indianapolis to relax those things. Again, Jim Guthrie up high. He's been off the pace a little bit all day and giving the guys a lot of room. Oh, Stewart's in trouble. Stewart's in trouble.
Stewart is way off the pace. Coasting down the backstretch, he will make it into the pits. The track was clear for him to come across. But something has broken. It won't turn. Something's broken in the steering of Tony Stewart.
We're hearing on the radio it won't turn right. Well, on ovals, most of the time you don't have to turn it right, but to keep them on the straightaway here, you actually have to be able to turn both ways.
19 career Pep Boys Indy Racing League starts. 9 of those races, he's not finished. See if Larry Curry and crew can fix it. Dick Bertrand?
Well, they're not really entirely sure what's going on, but all the work is at the back end of this race car, and this is such a disappointment. Last night, they worked on this car. They basically dismembered this entire car, took it all apart, checked absolutely everything, replaced anything that looked potentially faulty, just wanting to be absolutely sure that nothing failed. But something on the back end of the race car has failed. The engine cover is in the process of coming off, so the mechanics can go to work, and there is a very unpleasant odor up here from that race car.
Something in the rear of Tony Stewart's car. Again, the pole sitter, but again, mechanical problems.
Well, and it's amazing. You talk about the politics. We're down in the pits, and we smell an odor. That's usually not something that is involved with the steering gear. So when they're saying that the car won't turn right, but they smell bad breath, those don't go together.
Scott Sharp took the lead from Tony Stewart, drove away from him, and continues to hold the front spot over Buddy Lazier. Ralph?
Dennis LaCava is the chief mechanic for Buddy Lazier. Boy, those yellows really helped you guys get yourself back up to speed. Are you right where you wanted to be now?
We're doing good. We made a lot of changes last night. Kind of used that first run to sort the car out. We seem to have it going pretty good, so we're going to have to run it out.
And back in the pits with Tony Stewart.
Scotty, take a nice and easy. It looks like Tony Stewart is out of the race.
Well, you heard him try.
Negative. Just take it nice and easy. Just stay doing exactly what you're doing.
Now on the lower left of your screen, we've got onboard telemetry with Scott Sharp from the Delphi Automotive folks. Let's have a look here.
Yeah, we do. We got miles per hour. Obviously, you can see that it doesn't vary very much. I mean, he's 187, 88 almost at the end of the straightaway, but he only loses 4 or 5 miles an hour in the middle of the corner. And this is just after the crew has radioed to him and said, hey, your chief competition has just fallen out. Take it easy. We've got a ways to go. You don't have to push it.
Now, the RPM is limited in the Pep Boys IRL, 10,500. They have to have an RPM limiter that cuts power to the engine at that point. Acceleration percentage from 0 to 99. How far are those throttles open?
Yeah, that's really the throttle angle there. And you can see he's rolling out of it a little bit. But the way we've got to calculate it, actually, right right there, we're only going to see 98 as full throttle. So, but again, we're seeing these numbers just after the crew has told him to take it easy. The competition is dwindling. It's falling by the wayside. And let's make sure we're not one of them.
And look at the lateral acceleration, Tom. 4.5 G's through these corners.
Well, and the real key there, you can see negative on the straightaways. It actually falls the other way. That's why you have to turn the car right when you're going down the straightaway. But we see 4 G's. The real key to the G-force here is how long you sustain the G-force. These are long corners, so you sustain the G's for quite a while, and that becomes a physical problem from a driver's standpoint.
Now, folks, to give you an idea, your average four-door sedan, as hard as you can throw it through a flat corner, will do about 3/4 of 1 G. So this is some cornering force. Dick Bergeron.
This is a constant velocity joint. This is the drive shaft of the car that runs to the wheel and turns the wheel. And that bearing is what has failed on Tony Stewart's car. He has asked the mechanics to replace this entire system with a new one so that he can at least go fast enough to run around the bottom and pick up points. And that is a long way from having the potential to win this thing today, Mike.
Snake bit, Tony Stewart, but he can get back in this race. 183 laps completed, Dover Downs. We'll be right back.
I have your son.
Sean won.
I want $2 million.
Sean?
Are you going to pay me?
I want a son.
This is your ransom. I'm offering this money as a reward on your head.
Mel Gibson, Renny Russo, Gary Sinise.
If I don't get the cash, in 1 hour, this kid is dead. Give me back my son. Give me the money.
Get
it! Ransom, the mega movie, premieres Saturday at 10:05. Sky Movies Scream 2.
Time,
fishy,
and you time. The Messiah is the time when you want to.
It's good to know you can see Bobby's on the beat. Or take a quiet drive through the countryside. In a land where an Englishman's home is his castle, you can still find the odd thatched roof. And in London, you can see a pearly queen or two. It's good to know things haven't changed a bit. The Rover 200.
One to watch. An anonymous assassin with an unthinkable target.
Perfect.
Bruce Willis. Richard Gere. The Jackal. Rent the video now.
And it's good to know that with prices from £8,995 and 0% APR, a Rover 200 is within your reach.
And welcome back. Well, this is really turning out to be some race. While our colleagues in America were on a break, there's been yet another incident, another accident, this time involving Robbie Unser and Christopher Tate. This is a real blow because he's the youngest or the latest in a whole generation of racers in the States, isn't he?
Yeah, that's right. It's a real shame. I'd just taken a side bet with Chris here that Robbie was going to get up there on the podium. And as a rookie, that would have been a great performance on a track as tough as this. But it's caught him out, and he's gone into the wall hard. That's 8 major impacts against the wall. What a racing family, though, the Unsers. If you remember, right back at the beginning, you said there was one USAC race here in 69.
Yeah.
Bobby Unser was on the pole. Now, all these years later, another member of the dynasty is there, running in the top 6. He'd been going well all afternoon. And that's going to take some time to clear up, and they've had to use extinguisher on the circuit as well.
Let's go back now and hear what's happening.
In that situation, he got out slow, but you could see how the left front had been pushed all the way into the tub area. And car owner Eddie Cheever, obviously concerned. He's now lost both cars today at the Monster.
And I believe, would they both be write-offs, Tom? Can you repair one of those carbon fiber tubs like that?
Well, you'll have to evaluate it. There'll be some parts and pieces. You know, there might be a brake caliper that they can say or something. But
the tub itself, is that a write-off? Or can they, do they patch and repair them?
Robbie's doesn't look very good right now. No. Eddie's, you know, they'll just have to evaluate that. And again, it looks like he does have some kind of problem on the left leg somewhere.
With Ari Leyendijk's car.
Way up here, you'll see, is Robbie Unser in this replay. The lead car there. And again, it very similar, just jumped sideways, very similar to Steve Knapp, except the other end of the racetrack. He gets down in the middle of the corner thing, just jumped backwards. And again, jump backwards, getting into the left side first, just slamming the left side. And again, right here, you can see the left front is pushed all the way into the tub. Now, for the tire to get in there, it's got to push the suspension pieces through the side of the tub. And again, that probably caused Robbie the problem on his left leg. You can see the car just grinding to a stop. Parts and pieces. Everything's just floating to the bottom. Carbon fiber, wings. A lot of debris, all kinds of debris, parts and pieces everywhere.
But Robbie Unser climbed out. He sat up in the car, talked with the medical officials, reached down and was feeling around the left leg area before he finally did climb out of the car and get a little help into the ambulance. There's his team owner, Eddie Cheever. Cheever has not yet had time to change into street clothes after the accident that he's been involved with Greg Ray. That took Cheever driving what was then the third place car out of the race.
Well, again, heading over to make sure his drivers are all right. I played golf with Eddie this week, and he said he had a lot of guys interested in buying his team. And first thing I ask him is, when are you going to close? Because it's not a profitable situation owning these race cars.
Cheever's second car is on the hook. CBS Sports coverage of the Pep Boys 400K will continue after this word from your local station.
Well, yet another incident. Thankfully, it does appear that Robbie Unser is okay, but it raises questions yet again about the suitability of this circuit. And my two guests here in the studio, I think you both feel, do you not, that this track is starting to cause really problems that shouldn't be facing the drivers and the teams?
I fear so, yeah. I mean, we're wondering about just the nature of the transition from the sharp angle banking down to the straightaway banking, and that seems to be that Robbie Unser's accident was in the same place.
Absolutely.
As the previous accident that affected Knapp and so on as well. I mean, this is...
It's almost identical, the way the car left the middle virtually of the track and into the wall, and this backward impact.
Monster mile, they call it, and they're not kidding, are they? This is really doing us not much good as a spectacle in constant competition, and it's a worrier for these drivers. I hope Robbie Unser's legs are all right.
Yeah, absolutely. Chris, you have to say that from the driver's point of view, I would imagine the teams too, there's going to be repercussions to all this, because that nobody wants to go to a circuit like this and see everything just destroyed.
Well, we just heard from one of the American commentators who'd spoken to Eddie Cheever, who owns his own car plus the car of Robbie Unser there, and he was saying that the team owners are not making profit. Well, you know, these teams aren't there just for the fun of it. They're there as a business, and the reason they're not making a profit at the moment is because every other race they get a car smashed into the wall, and that
sure.
You just don't have a small or cheap accident in this.
But it's 30 years since these cars last raced. You imagine it's going to be another 30 before they go back, because I mean, this is just getting beyond a joke. I mean, this could be very serious.
Yeah, it may well be a while before they come back here. I mean, as we know, the NASCAR cars race here twice a year. But those cars really are built like trucks. They're very strong,
yeah.
But they're big, heavy cars, and they're able to withstand the beating of the rough surface.
Sure. Final brief point, Christopher, before we go back to the action.
The problem for the IRL schedulers is that all the new circuits, the new ovals in the States, are being built in the Midwest and the Sun Belt, as they call it. And it's very important for the IRL to be up in the major metropolitan eastern seaboard, which is where Dover Downs is, right next to Washington, D.C., the nation's capital, and so on. But, you know, if it means running on a snow-damaged circuit, it's going to cause problems, and it is.
Yeah, it's certainly really not a risk worth taking, is it? Because, as you say, snow damage, ice damage, whatever, it's never worth it.
Well, an exciting race still to go. We've still got a few laps to go. Let's hope there are no injuries and we have a clean run to the finish.
I mean, you can understand them wanting to keep a race in that part of the world, sure, but there has to be a better option, doesn't there?
There has to be a better option, and the problem is, as I say, there are a lot of circuits in Texas and in the southern states that they could go and run on, and they're going to Charlotte next. And testing this week, Tony Stewart lapped Charlotte at 228 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And when you have an accident at that speed, that's not so funny.
Well, now, don't worry, because at home, you're not missing any of the action. Our colleagues in America are still on a commercial break. We're keeping the action going here in the studio, but I think we can now go back to the track and rejoin CBS.
sitting there down at the inside of the corner. Our coverage from Dover Downs will continue after this.
Well, it's all happening thick and fast, isn't it? They're catching us slightly unawares, but we were able to go briefly back to the circuit. But as you can see, our colleagues are taking quite a few commercial breaks, certainly more than we would like. But don't worry, you won't miss any of the action. We'll be going back there just as soon as we can. Christopher, let's just come back to the race itself, because, again, it seems we're getting bogged down in detail here. We're losing the overall picture. How do you think this is going to turn out? Because you were mentioning just briefly a few moments ago, you fancied that Ari Lyondyke, who, of course, is pretty well a veteran these days, he's actually looking as if he's got the luck, and who knows, he could win this.
Yeah, I mean, Ari's been around a long time. First won Indy, the big Indy 500 in 1990, and won it again a year ago. He's going to be strong. Scott Sharp, I think the car looks so much better set up. Those onboard pictures that Chris was talking about earlier with Buddy Lazier's car.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't see him getting round to the front unless everybody else falls off. So I'm looking for Lyondyke to come up through, maybe to third, maybe second. But I don't know, it's going to be hard to catch Sharp.
Scott Goodyear, we understand, is making a bit of a charge up through the field. And, you know, last time we saw him, he's on the end of a tow rope, so anything could happen.
And the Frenchman Stephen Gregoire is now up in the top six, and he's a bit of a silent runner. I admire his style. He just keeps in there steady.
Yes.
And he's been running very sensibly on the pace all through the afternoon.
Chris, I haven't actually sort of pinned you down, really, as to the way you think this race might pan out. I know it's impossible, but get a pin, and who do you reckon?
Well, I'll do just that. That's the thing with this type of racing. I mean, you have to say that Tony Stewart's car looked a fairly safe bet to be on the podium, but he had some mechanical damage. It's just so unpredictable for that reason. You know, we've got Scott Sharp in a fairly comfortable position.
Are you a Lyondyke fan? I mean, you know, Christopher seems to think he's going well.
No, I prefer the younger driver. Scott Sharp, he'll do it.
You think so?
If his car lasts.
You never know, do you? Right, I think we are just about able to cross back to the circuit. Let me just remind you, it's the Dover Downs action. That's where it's coming from. It's the Pep Boys 400. Thankfully, the racing is just about to get underway once again. We can now cross back to our colleagues at CBS in a moment. We understand slight delay in getting back to the racing. It's in fact taking longer than we thought, because there has been so much incident, so much action both on and off the track here. But I think we can now go back to Dover Downs. No, we're waiting on that word any second now.
We have on Steve Knapp, but you saw him helicoptered out of the speedway to Kent General Hospital. It was reported that he was awake and alert and talking with the caregivers, and has been taken to the hospital for observation. If we get further word, we'll pass it on to you. Brian Tyler back in the race. 47 laps down. They made repairs to Tyler's car, and he's going back out. 1969 was the last time Indy cars were at Dover, August 24th. Competitors that day include number 12, Gordon Johncock, who finished second, number 15, Al Unser Sr., and number 20, Jim Malloy. Mario Andretti's in the number two. He's the sandwich there. And on the inside, 68, Jerry Carl. And there's your winner, Art Pollard, number 57, in a Plymouth-powered Indy car. August 1969. A.J. Foyt was in that race. He finished 19th, Tom, and A.J. took home $285.
Well, back then, the cars only cost about $500. Did you see those things?
Yeah. Buddy Lazier in the pits.
Second place.
And away.
Again, this is late pit stops under this yellow, trying to give them enough fuel in these cars to maybe go to the finish.
Scott Sharp, race leader behind the old Aurora pace car. Sharp started racing in karts at age 8. He's going to pit this lap and make a stop and cycle around there. Won 50 of 75 go-kart stops and was on his way. His dad, a multiple-time SCCA champion.
Well, getting down on the apron, so he's going into the pits.
Hey, watch your speed. Let's make it nice and easy. Put it right on the marks. Nice, clean pit stop.
Should be his last pit stop of the day. He won his first ever SCCA race. There's Jim Harbaugh, Baltimore Ravens quarterback. You're going to see a lot of him on CBS this fall. He's the part owner of race team here.
Reset fuel.
Scott Sharp in.
Go, 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 go.
Quick stop.
quick start, a lot of excitement, but stopping under the yellow, sometimes...
Excellent stop.
Again, you can hear the team manager talking to driver.
Ari Leyendijk was on pit road at the same time. They needed to get Sharp out ahead of Leyendijk to maintain that lead.
Look at the smoke off of Leyendijk. Exiting the pits, there was a lot of smoke and things on the left rear in this area as he left the pits. Here you hear listening to a driver asking the crew, can we make it to the end? But what do we see here? Is that smoke coming out of that thing? Something's on fire. Something's leaking out of that thing.
A little excess fuel, perhaps, that was left there in the recess of the fuel filler or the overflow.
That could have been it. It should have been gone by then, but very possible.
Ralph Shaheen is with Jim Harbaugh.
Well, you got camp opening up tomorrow, but how's it going out here? Getting a bit of a workout in early?
Well, I'll tell you what, a race like today makes me glad I play a nice, safe sport like football.
Pretty heavy impacts out here today, huh?
Yeah, it's been wild. We got a tough break early in the race with the Dr. Jack there, and those are the cards that you're dealt. But, you know, the guys have really improved. I think we're back up to seven, so just kind of fighting for points today.
Just make sure you don't overexert that right arm.
Yeah, you know, not a tough thing.
Well, he's a car owner. He's got to sign checks with that. That's pretty exerting. You'll see a lot of Jim Harbaugh Sunday, September 6th on CBS at 1 p.m. when his Ravens face off against the Pittsburgh Steelers.
He'll have shoulder pads and flag jacket when we see him in the football field. He might think he needs that in the pits. There's a lot of scrapnel out there.
No sponsor logos there, not too many of them. That's one of the many games you'll see on CBS this fall. The Goodwill games are coming up next on CBS, USA versus Puerto Rico basketball.
Mike, I must have been talking to Goodyear because he went back
right at the conclusion of our event. Tony Stewart is back in the race. He is 28 laps down after repairing the right rear drive shaft and constant velocity joints.
Well, and you get back to the problem they had back in this area, the drive shafts. The car is very soft. Because of the roughness of the racetrack, they have to have a lot of travel. They soften the cars up so it'll get over the bumps. When you soften them up, the car travels a lot farther and puts those half shafts in bad angles, and it's hard in the CV joints.
We're under caution at Dover, and we'll be right back.
Ever had football fantasies? Imagine your best 11. Who would they be? Get real. Choose 11 players and one manager worth $45 million and register your team with Sky Sports Interactive before live coverage commences on Sky Sports on August the 16th. Make all the right moves and you could win the £50,000 first prize. Sky Football Fantasia. Dream on.
We like... to keeping you moving than the RAC.
Evolution isn't just a theory. It's happening right now. The proof is all around us in the living world. Sometimes family resemblances are buried deep in the genes. But sometimes we can trace characteristics from one generation to the next. Improving, evolving, emerging.
Sleeker, smarter, more responsive. The new Renault Laguna.
When we think about making our savings grow on the stock market, many of us won't even dip our toe in the water because we think it's complicated, only for the rich, and we might lose everything.
Wrong, wrong, wrong.
Change the way you save. For the Advanced Savings Account Pack, call 0800 626262.
But don't worry about that.
If you look there, if you look that side.
That's fine. No, that's just how...
No, but it's going that way.
No, it's okay. Because you get the sun in the morning, lovely.
Where's West?
Why do you whisper green grass? Why tell the trees what ain't so?
You can cut one-third off UK calls on Saturdays in September.
Call 0800 241424 now to register for BT's Chatterday Saturday.
But once again, fast, Tony Stewart way down to the race leader after repairing that right rear.
Well, you can see the traffic on this restart. I mean, they were interlocked wheel to wheel and somehow got away with that, Mike.
Lead battle's a good one. Buddy Lazier, Scott Sharp dives to the inside. And there's Sharp taking the lead at turn one.
Just getting by Lazier. I mean, just smoked him off getting in.
Fourth place battle, Marco Greco, Davey Hamilton. Marco's had a good run here today. When the leader's in trouble. Turn four, Leyendijk pounded the wall.
Car five, turn four.
Everybody's going to get past.
Car, hold on, pace car.
But again, another car spins and knocks the whole left side off the car.
Well, you see Leyendijk, he threw the steering wheel out. That's a good sign because, again, this is very similar. Backing in left side, collapsed against the tub.
I feel this workout too good, Ron. I had to go to the outside.
Okay. Go lean on fuel.
Harry Leyendijk is okay. Eighth caution flag of the day. Jeff Ward hit that same part of the wall on lap 21. Sam Schmidt at lap 95. Eddie Cheever and Greg Ray crashed at lap 104. Steve Knapp into the wall at lap 150. And at lap 183, Robbie Unser hit the wall hard. And now, Harry Leyendijk becomes the sixth major crash of the day at lap 203.
I can't tell there. Leyendijk looks a little disgusted. I don't know if he's disgusted with himself, the car, the racetrack, or one of the other drivers.
Pits are open. Pits are open. You got him, pace car. Good job.
Giving a what happened to someone on pit road. There is Leyendijk's crew, and let's go on board with Ari Leyendijk.
This is down the back straightaway here, entering turn three. Oh, you can hear. It sounded like the motor locked up or something. It just stopped all of a sudden and jumped the back end sideways. So it almost sounded like the motor froze up right there. And when the back wheel stops spinning, the back catches the front.
Because you could hear the engine under full power, and then suddenly the engine stops.
You could hear the noise went away instantaneously.
Fluid from the impact coming out, and a little fire extinguisher foam going down there on remains of Ari Leyendijk's car. He is okay. Every driver thus far has walked out of the care center except Steve Knapp, who has taken alert and conscious to the local hospital for observation. But this did not appear to be a loss of control or a cut tire. Listen to the sound of the engine here on this replay.
Well, again, the motor is running flat out and all of a sudden it stopped. This is the end of the car. You can see him up against the wall. He's already into the wall. You can see traffic trying to get by underneath. Davey Hamilton right here making a big swerve down. Kenny Breck gets by. He's a bunch of laps down early in the race.
And the first car to go by, Tony Stewart at speed, dropped off the banking, pounded down on the apron, and got through. Watching Scott Goodyear's view.
You can see Leyendijk already up above. Goodyear's trying to get down low, and then another car.
Marco Greco.
Underneath him. So just trying to avoid trouble. Some of these guys get out of the throttle, see it happening a lot quicker than some of the other guys.
And another car destroyed by the Monster Mile. That's no longer just a funny tag that's been put on this speedway. It has had these cars for lunch today. One driver practice here and before qualifying elected not to continue. He's with Ralph.
That would be Buzz Calkins. Buzz, why did you end up not racing here this weekend?
Well, I think it was kind of the circumstance where we blew an engine right before qualifying yesterday, and I really wouldn't have had enough time to get back into the qualifying line. So we came out, we've kind of been, you know, the last couple of races kind of been going on kind of a downward spiral. So I think we need to take this race off and take Charlotte off, kind of reevaluate where we are, and get back into a more competitive position by the time we get back to Colorado Springs.
Now, you had an opportunity to get some practice laps in, and you've obviously watched what happened here today. What's your assessment of this racetrack today and what you're seeing?
Well, I think everybody knew coming into it was going to be a difficult place just because how bumpy it was and the speeds and how close everybody was running together. So it's actually been a lot better than maybe I would have expected it at first. But, you know, I don't think there's any problems with the track. They did a good job grinding down a lot of the bumps that made it better than where we were when we came back testing. And so it's just one of those things that's tough on cars and, you know, just hope for a safe finish.
We'll be going next to the Goodwill Games where the U.S. leads Puerto Rico 14-8 in basketball. You'll see that at the conclusion of today's race. 41 laps to go here at Dover Downs, Delaware. We'll be right back.
World Cup over. Two missed their chance to shine on the world's greatest stage. Shearer, Gascoigne. For them, retribution begins here. Newcastle, Empoli, Benfica and Middlesbrough battle it out for the JD Sports Cup, coming soon on Sky Sports 2.
Oh, Ellie McCoist, that must be one of your finest achievements. A 0% finance offer from Vauxhall.
Yeah, God, fantastic.
Talk us through the deal, will you?
Here. Well, I nipped into the showroom, paid the deposit, and went off down the right in a brand new car. Brilliant, eh?
And the small print on the screen?
It's all part of the modern advertisement.
So you'll continue paying 0%?
Yeah. Yeah, can I go now?
Any chance of a lift home?
Okay, cheers.
No?
Bye now.
Oh, well, I'll take the bus then.
0% finance from Vauxhall. Bye!
Whatever rate you speak at, make sure it's the cheapest. Vodafone's new off-peak rate is just 5p a minute. For the cheapest digital national off-peak calls, the word is Vodafone.
In a world of tough decisions,
never gonna make it.
One simple action can mean success.
Running out of time.
Beyond your wildest dreams.
Good to have you with us.
The first account. It will change your life forever.
Bonjour, my British chums. I would like to introduce you to my new fruity friend. It is Round Tree, the intensely fruity fruit pastel lolly. Oh, he says he is English. But it cannot be. You are too fashionable, too colorful, too fruity to be English. Oh, but I forgot le stick. So plain, so pedestrian, so boring, so British. An intensely fruity experience on a very British stick.
One to watch. An anonymous assassin with an unthinkable target.
Perfect.
Bruce Willis. Richard Gere. The Jackal. Rent the video now.
Inside this tiny PC is a big built-in advantage. We make it with technology so advanced, it will handle the software of the future. Our home entertainment system has the latest Intel Pentium 2 processor. It gives you awesome graphics at breathtaking speed. Yet all this quality comes at a remarkably low price. Because we don't just make our PCs, we sell them direct in our own nationwide showrooms. Come and see amazing tiny PCs with Intel Pentium 2 processors. Call 0800-321-000 for your nearest showroom.
You've probably been there on holiday.
Welcome to Spain.
You probably loved it.
The sand. Sea.
Beaches.
You probably adored the people.
Bit mucky, bit smelly.
Revolting.
You probably enjoyed their hobbies.
They chuck cows off buildings and that.
And you must have loved their food.
No traditional restaurant is complete without bull's testicles.
Relive your favourite holiday moments.
Goodness gracious, his bowls are on fire.
Bloody Foreigners, tonight at 10, first on Sky One.
Yeah.
That's Ron Hemelgarn, Buddy Lazier's car owner. Lazier in second place right now. Let's go to the pits. Ralph Shaheen.
Dennis LaCava is the chief mechanic for Buddy Lazier. Well, Dennis, you've seen a lot of incidents today. Are you concerned now as we get to 207 laps that maybe this is a little bit of uncharted territory as far as reliability goes?
Well, definitely is. This track's taken its toll so far on quite a few cars, but I believe that our car is set to go.
Did you have an opportunity to do anything before you came to Dover that might make yourself feel a little bit more comfortable as you reach this point of the race?
Well, we knew that this was going to be a very tough track on cars, so just knowing that was a big plus. We tried to prepare the car a little better from a standpoint to run the distance.
How's Buddy hanging in there? Is he surviving the mental and physical strain?
Buddy's doing well. He's doing exceptionally well.
Remember as well, gentlemen, that Buddy Lazier was a world-class skier, so he is also a very exceptional athlete.
We're inside Buddy's car, and I think one thing we're not going to see with the Lazier car is a CV problem, because this thing is suspended a lot stiffer than Stewart's car. Again, maybe making it not as quick, but more reliable because you're not stressing some of the drive joints.
We'll be back to Dover Downs to get an update from Michelle Tafoya with the USA versus Puerto Rico basketball when we come back. You're watching the Pep Boys.
Well, it's all starting to happen, really, but unfortunately rather slowly. Obviously, this race taking shape, but some of the incident is spoiling the overall racing action. Christopher Tate and Chris Goodwin are with me here in the studio in London. Christopher, a question for you first. Just on a general note, I think one of the things that's fascinating here at this end is hearing so many English voices when we're listening to drivers and teams talking. A lot of English voices there. So what's the story?
It's a great feature of American racing, David. You walk down the pit lane anywhere in America and you can hear English, Australian and New Zealand voices, because for some reason, with Britain as the centre of the world's motor racing industry, that's where everybody goes. And if you're a good English engineer, race engineer, and you're rather fed up with standing in the pouring rain at Alton Park, you know, a couple of years in the sun doing IndyCar racing, good stuff. And we hear a lot of them on the radio talking to the drivers. And that's true down pit lanes in all the major American series except NASCAR.
Right, and Chris, is this your experience knowing the American scene as you do, that English drivers and team managers and whatever, they're held in high regard by some of the Americans?
Absolutely, yeah. I think it's commonly known that the standard, general standard of motor racing is higher over this side of the Atlantic, or it has been anyway. Mm. And over the years, the Americans have benefited from the knowledge and experience that the English drivers, engineers, mechanics, and designers have got to offer.
Let's just go back to the incident. There's been so much incident here. Let's look at Ari Lyondyke. This is what happened to him. And what did you make of this?
Well, again, it's a strange part of a corner to suddenly go off, and it is suddenly too. And I would hazard a guess in this case that the engine may have suddenly seized. Something certainly at the rear end of the car is broken. I put my money on the engine going, because all of a sudden it was going on full song.
It just seemed to cut, doesn't it?
Yeah. I noticed, looking at the telemetry figures from one of the onboard shots we had earlier on, the engine revs on these cars change by only about 500 revs. They're running at about 10,500 revs. Yeah. It drops to just below 10. The engines are being run flat out all the way around, and it's hard work for an engine to do that.
That is fascinating, isn't it? Looking at that insight, you're on board with the driver, you're getting this fantastic readout of what's happening to the car, the G-force and so on. Yeah. It's a great innovation and something I'd like to see more of. I don't know about you.
Yes, I think they're using that as a bit of promotion on Scott Sharp's car. His sponsors are Delphi Automotive Systems, and they're in that business. But the telemetry makes great reading, and a driver with Chris's experience is able look at that, see so much more. It makes it so much more interesting for the television viewer as well. It's great. Let's have more of it.
Yes, I mean, it really does put you in the hot seat. I mean, we've seen any number of cars go around a track, but actually to go on board and get that instant readout and feel of what's happening to the car, I think is most impressive, especially those G-forces around the bends.
Yes, amazing, aren't they? The only bit we missed from the onboard, however, was Tony Stewart with the dashboard falling into his lap, which I think would have given all of us a real start there on the circuit. I disagree with Buzz Calkins, who was interviewed earlier, saying that he didn't think the drivers would feel too badly about this circuit. I think if you go to them now and have a little democratic vote, I think the Lyondykes and the Cheevers and their experience is going to say, boys, I'm not quite sure this is a place we want to come back to that frequently.
I think we're going to be hearing more about this particular race circuit, don't you? Right, I think now we can go back. It's the CBS race cam, and let's go back now to Dover Downs.
Scott Sharp's rear end and way up at the top of the screen there. There's Buddy Lazier. And the right side of your screen, you're on board with Lazier. Battle for third place. Marco Greco having his finest day in his Pep Boys Indy Racing League career. He's in the red car leading Davey Hamilton. He has never finished higher than eighth this season, higher than fourth in his career.
Well, these
he's
guys,
in third place car.
These guys started on opposite ends of the field. Greco had a problem qualifying, had to start at the very back of the pack. Davey Hamilton started right towards the front, so it's interesting to see how the race develops and what goes on.
Steve Knapp airlifted out earlier. Further examination of his foot and ankle is the report that we have from Kent General Hospital here in Dover. Next time by 2:21 complete. The board is updated. 2:48 is the race. 27 laps to go.
You can watch the different cars come off on these camera angles, how much they bounce around compared to each other. Again, quite a bit of difference in on the handling packages that these cars are attempting to get the job done with. Again,
Marco Greco. International Sports Limited for Greco. And up front, Scott Sharp, who won his first ever amateur sports car race in 1984. First time he ever entered at Briar, which is now New Hampshire International Speedway.
You can see him shuffle his hands on the steering wheel. This is a little bit unusual. A lot of guys don't change hand positions on the wheels as much as Scott does, but it's probably something that he developed through his road racing beginning into the IndyCar situation.
Let's check with Dick Bergeron.
Ari Landyke has just walked out of the care center. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. I just have a couple of scratches and my my shoulder is a little bit sore. That shoulder has had a lot of bangs lately.
What happened? What put you in the wall?
I really don't know. My car, we put a new set of tires on, and on the restart, running a few laps, the car felt better than it had all day long. And I figured my car is right now when I need it to be right. And then at the bottom of three, it must have bottomed out and lost the rear end, because other than that, I really don't have any explanation.
Why so many crashes today?
I think maybe the bumps have a little bit to do with it. And when you go out of the pits, tire pressures are not up yet altogether, and maybe that's part of the reason. But I sure like to know exactly why I spun out.
Now, the racetrack has spent a tremendous amount of money and effort to try to smooth this place out and make it hospitable for the Indy cars. It just has not worked out today. Mike?
Well, they've spent a lot of money and done a tremendous job here, Dick. But still, this track takes its toll on stock cars and on Indy cars.
Well, Leyendyke made a good point. It was right after a change. The car felt good, but the tire pressures might not have come up. Now, with a low tire pressure, the car's going to hit the ground harder. And he might have bottomed the car out, just like he indicated, and knocked the thing sideways. So you got to take a couple laps to get the tires up to pressure, and again, when they come up to pressure, they hold the car off the ground better. Again, I'm not sure that's what happened, either is he, but something knocked that thing completely sideways.
One of nine cars to be taken out of this race of attrition by crashes. Six very hard hits with the wall. Ari Leyendyke the latest, Robbie Unser, Steve Knapp, Eddie Cheever, Greg Ray, Sam Schmidt, and Jeff Ward have had hard impacts with the wall. And all climbed out except Knapp was assisted from his car, and they're having a look at his leg and ankle, or ankle and foot, rather. Jim Guthrie just being bypassed by Lazier, having a good comeback drive. Now here's second place, Buddy Lazier in that purple car. And you see how much ground he has to make up on race leader Scott Sharp there at start-finish.
Well, I'm a little bit surprised. You know, with the kind of attrition we're seeing, you would think that the leader would just go hard enough to keep ahead of somebody else, because at this point, you can't afford to put any more stress on these things than they've already received.
Ralph?
Mechanic for Scott Sharp. Are you guys setting Scott up to just casually cruise it in, or are you still running as hard as you were in the beginning?
We're still trying to keep the pressure on Scott to stay ahead, of course, but we've told him that he can relax to a point. We still have to push him as far as we can.
Now, what kind of a point would that be? How hard do you have to push it? 7/10?
Stay ahead of second place.
It's interesting. This is inside Scott Sharps again. He's just turning laps at 180. That's about as quick as we've run all day. So he hasn't backed it up
now,
too much as far as speed's concerned.
Excuse me. There's nobody in front of him. A whole straightaway in front of him. There's not another car. Whole straightaway behind him, there's not another car.
Well, and again, he's running speeds close to as quick as laps as they ran early in the race. And, somebody might indicate that you might give it a little more of a breathing room and try to get this equipment to last.
One driver that was assisted from his car after complaining about his left foot and ankle area was Robbie Unser. Dick Bergeron has an update.
An update from the care center, Mike, is that they're going to hang on to him here for a little while, then they're going to take him off to the local hospital and x-ray that foot. He also has a puncture wound to his knee, and they're going to take a look at that at the hospital. Other than that, seems okay.
Just stay doing exactly what you're doing. Buddy Lazier is not even close.
That's the instruction to Scott Sharp, and there is Buddy Lazier, the second-place car. Show you again how much ground Lazier has to make up. His last lap was quicker than Sharp's, 179 to 178 miles an hour. There's the interval.
Well, obviously, Lazier's got to keep the pressure on. He's got to work as hard as he can and just hope the car stays together. Sharp's got a little bit of a cushion here, and the crew is trying to indicate to him very diplomatically, take care of our race car.
31-19, USA's lead over Puerto Rico. Goodwill Games basketball is coming up next here on CBS. We are just 11 laps from the finish. First time the Indy cars have been to Dover Downs, Delaware, the Monster Mile, in 30 years.
You can see by the speeds, if you notice Sharp, he slowed down a little bit, so he's finally getting the clue. The crew's got to him and saying, hey, we need to bring it home another 10 or 15 laps.
A bit of lap traffic there. Lazier held just a little bit.
Yeah, he had to breathe it a little bit on the exit. There's just everybody runs out of room. You're in the same real estate area, and there's just not enough here at Dover.
Let's give you a rundown, because we will be going quickly to that basketball game in progress at the conclusion of this race. Right now, Sharp is the leader. You're with Buddy Lazier, the second-place car. Marco Greco, having a career day, is third. Davey Hamilton is fourth. Stefan Gregoire is fifth, one of his best efforts. Scott Goodyear lost five laps early on with a pit stop. He is now sixth. Jim Guthrie in his comeback drive after a bad crash at Indy. Guthrie is in seventh place. Tony Stewart, after a long stay on pit road to replace a drive shaft and constant velocity joint, Stewart is eighth. Ari Leyendyke is posted 10th based on laps completed. Kenny Breck, back after a stay with electrical problems. Then Robbie Unser. Tyler. Then Knapp, who is out of the race, as is Boisel. Greg Ray, Eddie Cheever.
Just let him go, buddy. Just let him go.
Sam Schmidt, Mark Dismore, Jeff Ward, Jack Miller, and John Paul Jr. That's the rundown of the entire field. There is second place Buddy Lazier, lapping at 177 miles an hour. He is a tick of the watch quicker than Scott Sharp every lap. There is the race leader, Scott Sharp.
Sharp was sort of stuck in traffic. I don't know if he was stuck, but he's just trying to be real careful at this point, trying to bring this thing home. But Lazier is closing the gap.
Sharp from Wilton, Connecticut. His dad, seven-time national champion road racer, Scotty, quickly followed in his dad's footsteps. Made it to IndyCar racing, where he's a two-time winner, 86 New Hampshire, and this year a winner at Phoenix. Buddy Lazier, second-place car. Wife Carol looking on. Three laps to go.
Well, next week, Mike, these guys go to Charlotte. They've been there before. They've had a lot of success, put on a great show. And so I'm sure some of these guys are holding their breath and looking forward to Charlotte next weekend.
As Buddy Baker would say, he holds a pretty wheel.
Actually, he shuffles that pretty wheel around a little bit, more so than some of these guys, but it's working today.
Scott Sharp, two to go, sweeps off underneath the overpass, the walkover bridge, down the back straightaway. That's the front stretch grandstands for the horse track that's inside the paved one-mile oval. And the white flag waves over Scott Sharp and Buddy Lazier. They're in the same straightaway. Sharp entering turn two as Lazier enters turn one, and Lazier closing.
You can see Lazier right back there. He's closed substantially, but a half a lap to go.
Turn three,
fourth corner, and Scott Sharp wins his third Pep Boys Indy Racing League event, and Buddy Lazier catches right to his rear wing at the checkered flag. Sharp now leads the points by 8 over pole sitter Tony Stewart. There's Stewart coming across on pit road. And it's the third win for Sharp.
See, Sharp, pretty happy. The team's pretty happy.
Former SCCA Trans Am and amateur champion. And on the 1 mile ovals, Tom, all of his wins have come on 1 mile ovals.
Well, great job today.
For Tom Sneva, Ken Squire, Dick Bergman, and Ralph Shaheen, I'm Mike Joy, saying so long from Dover Downs International Speedway, where Scott Sharp has won the 1998 Pep Boys 400K.
You guys hold the party till I get there?
This has been a presentation of CBS Sports.